session. Really don't think you were just showing us in your running. We're going to start our activity here at 5:40. We've got two multi-classification events to come. And we'll resume the action at 6 o'clock when we get back to the action board of qualification races for the World Championship. Welcome to Pond Sports here in Sheffield. This is the final session of day four of the British Gas Women's Championships 2013. We've got the election and entertainment to come for you. We've got the role for you to play a little bit later on as well. So do get yourself some of those kids in the audience, and you've got those clappers, stroke fans. You'll need them a little bit later on. We'd like to make as much noise as possible with those. We will tell you. Ladies and gentlemen, let me introduce you to our host for this evening's session, Mr. Andy Sixpick.
Good evening and welcome to, well, the penultimate final session of this British Gas Swimming Championships 2013. Obviously doubling as the World Championship Trials. Now, we saw an excellent final session yesterday evening. I'm expecting to see even better tonight. And we've got some excellent finals and semi-finals on the menu for you. Let's take a brief look at what's coming up. How about a World Short Course bronze medalist? Chimalor goes in the final of the women's 100 metre fly. And I tell you what, the 200 IMs tonight are hotly contested, both the male and the female events. In the male, you wouldn't like to pick a winner. The likes of Joe Rover, Roberto Pavoni, and also Dan Wallace will be vying for that number one position and a seat on the plane to Barcelona. In the females, well, Siobhan Marie O'Connor has been really on form in the heats and semi-finals, but she has the likes of Helen Miley, Amy Wilmot, and Sophie Smith behind her. So who knows what's going to happen in that final. We're going to have Georgia Davies is going in the 100 metre backstroke alongside the likes of Jess Fuller, Lauren Quigley and Lizzie Simmons. I think we should throw in some semi-finals too. Likes of Michael Jamieson and Francesca Hassel go in there. And there's a high calibre of multi-classification athletes in there as well. Plenty for you to sink your teeth into. So sit back, enjoy the finals and the semi-finals. But one of our main sponsors tonight, a Speedo. So take a look at this. Thank you.
Hello and welcome to the Fast Lane. We will be bringing you exclusive access from the British Gas Swimming Championships 2013 here in Ponsford, Sheffield. It is day four and we've had lots of action so far because this is the one and only chance for our British athletes to qualify for the FINA World Championships in Barcelona in just a few weeks' time. Now, over the course of the evening, we'll be bringing you live action from the finals. There's lots of preparations going on behind me. We're bringing you heats, highlights. We're bringing you lots of guests giving us all the information you need to know about what is going on here today. Now, alongside me, across the whole of this week and tonight, I have Ross Davenport, who I guess you all know now, but to give him a bit of an introduction, he's been competing for Great Britain for the last 10 years. He's a three-time Olympian and he is a two-time Commonwealth gold medalist. Also in the commentary box, we have Bob Ballard. So what a great team we have around us, and we hope you enjoy the rest of the evening. But for now, Ross, I want to talk about last night. What a great night we had last night. Lots of action that took place, and in particular, one young lady who really stole the show.
She certainly did. We had so many great swims last night, but you can't look any further than Jazz Carlin, like 1,500 metres for women, smashing the British record. By smashing it, took 18 seconds off the British record from, it was only set 2 years ago by Kerri-Ann Payne. So she's now the fastest in the world going into the World Championships, and fantastic performance.
And we may have some clips of last night's performances and the highlights to look forward to, because also she was also doing a world leading time. That was a time that really did prove the whole world what Britain is doing these days.
Certainly did. And she's only 3 seconds off the European record and only four or five seconds off the world record. So absolutely fantastic. And the pleasing thing was she had such a terrible time last year. She was coming back from injury. You can see her there thrashing away.
She's actually lapping other swimmers, isn't she?
Yeah, she is. She was that far ahead. She actually came around to lapping them. She comes into the finish and that's setting a new world leading time, new British record, and like I say, only 4 seconds off the world record.
So and it was 1,500 metres, which is quite an unusual event for the girls to do because it's not an Olympic event, is it?
It's not an Olympic event. It's only really swam in the international scene every 2 years at the World Championships. Also, we had Michael Jameson, had a storming performance. Again, he's now the world leading time going into the World Championships. He was incredibly surprised with his performance. He didn't expect to go that time. He's had a niggling injury, so he's been out of the water for a little bit. So he's obviously shown that he's got that grit and determination like all good champions have. And you know, see him there collecting his gold medal, pushed all the way by Andrew Willis.
And one gentleman we've seen an awful lot of this week is Benjamin Proud. We heard from him earlier on the show this week. He's just out there on his own. No one can touch him on the sprints.
No, and he wins this race by such a large margin. And over 50 metres, this is, you know, you can't even put into words that this is, oh, it's just incredible. New British record, Mark Foster's 10-year-old record that was got smashed by nearly half a second last night by Ben. So fantastic performance.
And it's quite unusual for a sprinter to be that far ahead. And it's almost like Adam Brown didn't want to compete in that race. He's focusing on the 100 tonight. So why is the sprinters not keeping up with him, or is he just taking that next step forward than everybody else?
He's just so good. He's so far ahead. And we've not really seen much of Ben. We saw him in the British Gas International meet earlier on in this year, and that's where he really started to show some great potential. But he's come here and not only showed that potential, but he's actually delivered. This is his biggest competition that he's ever swam. He would have sat at home, watched the Olympic Games last year, been inspired, and now he's going to inspire loads of other people that are sat at home watching the swimming, and hopefully should be going to the World Championships in a couple of weeks in Barcelona.
And to my calculations, we've got about 20 athletes that have done the qualification time. Two more days to go. Are we feeling pretty relaxed that we can reach that 30 marker, or should we start worrying?
Well, certainly not worrying. Like I say, 20 athletes have done their qualification time now. What you probably start seeing is repeat people that are already on the team start doing other events and qualifying for other events. So if we don't get that to the 30 people mark, it doesn't really matter because all the events will get filled when we get out to Barcelona. But I think it just shows you that we did have a disappointing Olympics last year, but now the rest of the guys have really stepped up to the mark, really taken the ownership on themselves to really deliver for Britain. 4 weeks out from the World Championships, and it's looking fantastic. And it's only 3 years till Rio.
And do we think those performances are going to carry on to Barcelona? They've only got 4 weeks.
This is the first time we've done the trials of this kind, being so close to the major meet. So it'll be interesting to see how they carry on this form. But if they're swimming this fast now, you know, certainly the sprinters are only going to get quicker over the next 4 weeks when they get more rest, when they get really pumped up for the big event. So British swimming is looking in safe hands.
That's good to hear, Ross. And that was pretty much a recap of last night, but we've got lots coming up for you tonight. And if you want to be involved in the show, you can give us a tweet at hashtag BGSC13 and we will read out some of your questions and some of your messages of support. Already, I can see on our stream tonight, we've got good luck, Michael Jameson, most importantly, have fun, and that's from Imaz Marriott. So he's supporting Michael Jameson in the 100 metres breaststroke tonight. We've also got good luck to Ben Proud, who we've also been seeing an awful lot of. I don't think he needs much luck, to be honest. He's doing so well. So keep those coming in and we will do our best to read them out. And I think you've got a little bit of a pitch for your Twitter, especially around Swim Britain, haven't you, Ross?
Yeah, that's right. I've entered a team for Swim Britain. It's trying to get the nation involved in swimming, getting increase the participation. It's British Gas are launching Swims Britain. And I've entered a team and I need 3 members to be part of my team. You need a team of 4, I'm a member, and I need 3 others. If you want to be a part of my team, then all you have to do is tweet in to I want to do Swim Britain's with @SwimmerRoss in Coventry, hashtag Swim Britain. That's all you have to do, and we'll pick 3 lucky, I'd say winners.
Yeah.
3 lucky winners to join me in Coventry swimming for Swims Britain.
And you went for a bit of a swim today, didn't you, Ross? I did join you. Were you feeling pretty fresh in the water today?
Yeah, I've still got it. You know, we went for a swim. You know, it was great to get back into the pool. Swimming's a brilliant sport to be a part of. And this is a fantastic initiative that British Gas are doing. So trying to get the whole nation involved. If you want to come in and have a swim, pop down to Coventry or check on the website, www.swimsbritain.co.uk. And there's all locations around the country, so you're not too far away from joining in.
Because lots of other top athletes are doing it. Yourself, Rebecca Radlington, myself. Who else is involved, do you know?
I think Jo Jackson, we're trying to rope her in as well, so I'll be seeing her later, so getting her roped in. David Walliams, the comedian, he'll be doing it. So there's plenty of celebrities going to be around, and it's going to be a fantastic event.
So that's up to you. You've got to get tweeting us. You've got to tweet Ross, and you could be joining him on the team for Swim Britain. Now, coming up tonight, we have multi-classification races, and we probably are aware that they are quite hard to understand. So I've put together a little bit of a video to hopefully make it a little bit more easier for you to see what is going on. Let's see how that pans out. This week, the disability racing will be ran as multi-classification racing. Now, this is a very difficult thing to understand, and even myself, as a Paralympic swimmer, does struggle to understand the concept. But actually, it can be very easy to understand, and I'm going to try and put that together for you in this particular package. Now, regardless of disability, all the swimmers will be competing in the same final. However, the winner will be decided on the British disability points that they earn, and that is all dependent on how many points and how close they are to the world record time. So that means that the person that touches the wall first with the fastest time isn't necessarily the winner. Actually, it could be the person coming in last because they may be closer to their world record. The British disability points is what you'll be hearing a lot, and if you see anything near the 1,000 points, it means they are very close to world record pace. Now, people like Eleanor Simmons could be very close to that 1,000 points because that is her particular personal best, and actually they could be the ones winning. And we know that Ellie will not be the fastest in the pool, but she could be the closest to the world record. British disability points are like FINA points, and it means that that is what is the most important thing to look out for at this particular event. And actually, if you want to know more about disability swimming and you want to understand the classifications a bit more, here's a quick little idea. The S stands for swimming and the number stands for the level of disability. 1 being the least most disabled and 10 being the least disabled. And then S11 to S13 is visually impaired and 14 is learning difficulties. But that's all quite a lot to take in. And the most important thing is that we look for the person with the most British disability points. And then they will be the winner and be top of the medal podium. And that does lead us very nicely into the next set of races. We have the 50 metres freestyle multi-classification races coming up, and there's lots of people for you to look out for. In particular, new on the scene, Stephanie Slater, who was actually an able-bodied athlete before she unfortunately became disabled in one of her arms, and now she's competing in the disability categories, and she's really taking the S8 field by storm. And it'll be really interesting to see how she gets on tonight. She's got the leading disability points, and I think she'll be one of the ones nearer the front of the race, so you want to keep your eye on her. We also have the men's race coming up after that with the likes of Matt Walker, who's an experience on his own. He's an incredible athlete, he's been going for many years, so lots of racing to look forward to before we then head into the AB racing. But without further ado, let's get the racing started, and I'm going to hand you over to Bob, who is now joined by Ross for the women's multi-classification 50 metres freestyle.
You've got it, Kate, as well. Ross Davenport's got it. You most definitely have it as well. Good evening, everybody. Welcome to Ponds Forge once again for day four of the British Gas Swimming Championships to get all those on the way to Barcelona, or in these cases, of course, those who've already made their way to Montreal. First of our finals tonight is the 50 metres freestyle for women. And you've heard some of the names mentioned. Hannah Russell's in there too. Stephanie Slater is looking for that S8 record, which she's only 1/10 of a second shy of this morning, 31.31. And the record held by Heather Fredrickson is 31.21. So we'll be keeping an eye on Stephanie Slater in lane number seven and see what Hannah Russell could do back in the pool once again. Personal best and British record of 27.91 for her.
And she's had a cracking start in lane four, leading the field by a good 2 metres. We've come to 15 metres to go.
And remember, these times convert to points. Not necessarily the winner will be the winner, if you know what I mean. Hannah Russell may touch first, but will convert her time to points. It's 880 now. Stephanie Slater, what can you do? 31.22. She is 1/100th outside of the British record. 9.65 for her. That will be the best total of any of the swimmers. Amy Maron with 8.91 in second place. Hannah Russell, 8.80 in third. So Stephanie Slater in lane seven there is the winner with 31.22. And as I say, she is 1/100th outside the record.
Kate was just talking about Stephanie Slater, and she certainly didn't disappoint. 31.22, 965 points to take the women's 50 metres multi-classification freestyle.
8.91 for Amy Maron, Hannah Russell in third place. And this is how all the tabulated configurations work out for the women's 50 freestyle. 31.22 for Stephanie Slater converting to 9.65, Amy Maron 8.91, and Hannah Russell with 8.80. And I'll mention Claire Cashmore because, of course, there's an involvement with our presenter in terms of their living arrangements. 8.37, we'll be careful where I go with this. 8.37, Claire Cashmore in fourth place. We will be hearing from Stephanie Slater a few hours time. Ross, some words?
Cracking swim to start off the night. Tonight's going to be such a brilliant evening session. We saw last night the highlights of probably Jazz and Michael Jameson, but tonight they've got a lot to live up for, and it's going to be a cracking evening. Look out for the women's 200 metres IM. That's going to be a close race, and I think between about three or four different girls could win that event.
We shall have to see. The men's 50 metres freestyle is coming up shortly, but the likes of Joseph Craig and Matt Walker and James Clegg and James Hollis. So we're going to look at the 0-8 on this race, and here it is. Three S7s at the top, an S10, an S12, another S10, and three different categories, S9 and S8. Matt Walker involved in this, Joseph Craig as well, and James Clegg, and James Hollis as well in lane five. I did say that we might hear from Stephanie Slater about how she just achieved the best time, most points in the 50 freestyle, and we're going to hear from her now with Andy Sixsmith.
Ladies and gentlemen, your first winner of the first final tonight, Stephanie Slater, make some noise for her. Stephanie, that was a fantastic swim there. What were your thoughts on the run?
It was a great race. This is the first time I've ever raced the 53, but just to miss that record.
But it must give you really a huge amount of confidence ahead of Montreal.
Oh yeah, definitely, because I'm in hard training at the moment, so obviously I've not tapered for this meet, but to come out and do that kind of swim, I'm just looking forward to the Worlds now.
Well, we'll let you get away and celebrate, Stephanie. Ladies and gentlemen, Stephanie Slater.
Well done, Stephanie Slater. Big smile on her face. And actually, that wasn't the race she's qualified for Montreal. She actually qualified in the 100 metres butterfly, so she'll be hoping to add that to her list of races, because all of the disability athletes have already qualified for their World Championships, which takes place in Montreal in August, a little bit later on this summer. So they've got all the pressure off them, unlike our AV athletes, who have got all the pressure on them. So as you can see, Stephanie was quite relaxed there. She was just taking in the atmosphere. And it is a great atmosphere we have here tonight. The crowds are here in their masses, really supporting our athletes, and as you can see, it's having an impact on their swims, and they're putting their top performances out there. And we have the next 50 metres freestyle coming up for you, and it's the men's. And as Bob has already mentioned, we've got the likes of Joseph Craig, who's already broken a world record here this week, so he is on top form. We've also got the likes of James Clegg, who's been a top performer this week, and then the likes of Matthew Walker, experience on his own. He has been doing this for years, and this 50 is where he excels. This is where he gets out there and he splatters the rest of his opponents, and he's really going to take this final. I believe he could be on top of the podium. And so I'm going to hand back over to Bob to see if that is the case. My money's on Matt. What about you, Bob?
Well, you mentioned him, Kate, and you never know quite what Joseph Craig's going to do. He's a little way outside David Roberts' S7 record, but he is improving so much with every single race. Here are the 10 who will go to start. Michael Jones in zero, Joseph Craig I mentioned, Matt Walker you mentioned, James Clegg in four, and the birthday boy from earlier this week, Jim Hollis, in lane five.
Matthew Walker's been doing this event for so long. He's 35 years of age. He's immensely qualified, immensely experienced. So I just wonder if that experience is going to shine through on this 50 metres freestyle.
Well, of course, we will have a head-to-head that you can watch with your own eyes. Lane one, Joseph Craig is an S7. Matt Walker is an S7 in lane two, as in Michael Jones in lane zero. So I'll tell you what, keep your eyes trained on lanes one and two here. Joseph Craig against Matt Walker. There are other battles going on, but this one is easy to determine because they are side by side. And it looks to pretty much like Matt Walker has got the speed. Joseph Craig on this occasion does not have the speed. It will be James Clegg who'll get to the wall first, the S12 swimmer. He holds the British record as it is. He's not going to beat it today, though. 25.52 for 7.31. Best of the bunch is Matt Walker, 8.91 for 28.75. That is a decent time. In fact, it's about a quarter of a second outside his personal best. In third place will be Joseph Craig. Matt Walker's delighted with that. 8.91. Of course, Kate is right always. She got it right on this occasion as well. And third place going to James Clegg with 7.31. So Matt Walker, once again, as he often has been here at Bonds Forge, is the victor in the 50 freestyle.
We spoke about his experience going into this race, and that certainly shone through. Matt Walker, 35 years of age, winning the 50 freestyle. These young whippersnappers can't keep up with him at the minute.
Just checking on that time for Joseph Craig. Just a little bit outside his personal best. 29.13 is his personal best. He reversed the 2 second digits, and there's the celebration from Matt Walker afterwards, looking towards his friends and family in the stand in another great celebration, another great victory for Matt Walker in a pretty decent time as well. So let's hear from the cheeky chappy, the jovial Matt Walker, another victory for him, and he will be telling us how he did it with Andy Sixsmith.
Well, I'll tell you what, ladies and gents, 50 fly last night, 50 freestyle tonight. How about Matthew Walker? Big achievement last night there, Matthew. What were your thoughts on that one?
It's a splash and dash. I just wanted to improve what I did this morning. Sets me up nicely for August. And hopefully I'll win that gold out there.
And I bet you just can't wait for it now, can you?
No, it's 5 weeks away. I want that 50.
Well, Matthew, well done as ever. We're not getting sick of a sight of you up here. Ladies and gentlemen, Matthew Walker.
And let's give you confirmation of the result of the 50 freestyle. 8.91 points for Matt Walker in the S7s. Joseph Craig, S7, 8.41. And James Clegg, who actually won the race visibly, but of course converted to points, comes in third place, 7.31. And a bit further down the list, James Hollis, 6.42 in the S10. So that's the result of the men's 50 metres freestyle.
Thanks very much, Bob. I did like to see that you mentioned that I am always right. I am a female. As you know, that's how it goes around here, because I'm a little bit outnumbered at the moment. So I'm going to take credit for that particular win. Well done, Matthew Walker. And I'm joined back with Ross now. I just want to get your thoughts on, you could still be in the water. He's 35 and he's still whacking out some great swims there. You're not thinking, maybe if I resort to sprints, you could still be going?
I don't move anywhere quick. So sprinting's certainly not my bag. But no, Matt Walker's fantastic. 35 years of age, still winning the British Championship. So he's a credit to the sport, and he's done such a lot for disability swimming in this country, and he still continues to shine that example through.
He's got the likes of Joseph Craig on his tail. Joseph Craig, obviously, more specific to the longer distance, 400 metres freestyle, but he's pushing Matt Walker, and I think he enjoys the competition.
Yeah, he certainly looks like the way. Joseph Craig's a fantastic swimmer. It's great to have a rivalry. It's great to push each other all the way. And you know, Joseph Craig is a lot younger than Matt Walker, but you know, it's just great that they can push each other each time they get into the pool, and it can only help British swimming.
So we've got lots of races coming up, and let's have a look at what we've got. We've got the likes of the 200 metres individual medley, male and female. We've got the women's 100 metres butterfly, and we've got the men's 100 metres backstroke. And what are you most looking forward to tonight?
We had such a great night last night. You know, it's going to be hard to repeat that, but I think with the swims we've got coming up and the swimmers we actually do have in the water tonight, we can topple last night. The 200 metres individual medley for the women is going to be fantastic. We alluded to it earlier. There could be four different girls that can win that event. You've got Sophie Allen, who's swimming fantastically well, won the 100 metres breaststroke, absolutely on fire, represented Great Britain at the Olympic Games at this event. You've got the reigning British champion, Hannah Miley. She's just not been on top form at the minute, but she's qualified for the World Championships, and she'll be hoping to put her best performance later on in the year. We've also got Siobhan Marie O'Connor, who's an up-and-coming star. So any of those three girls can win. We've also got Sophie Smith from Loughborough ITC. She seems to be doing every single event going. So between those four girls, it's going to be an immensely close race and a very exciting one.
Well, we know what you're looking out for, and you're talking about top performances. And people in particular that we're looking for top performances this week is the new National Performance Director, Chris Spice, and new head coach, Bill Furness. And earlier on this week, Ross Davenport caught up with them to hear their thoughts on the new programme and also the lead-up to Barcelona.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm here with the new head coach, Bill Furness, and the new performance director, Chris Spice, the new venture of British swimming. So, Chris, how has it been coming into a completely new sport as in swimming?
Thanks, Ross. Really challenging. I think from my point of view, I've had some great meetings across the nation with various people, but the pleasing thing for me is that we've got some great staff, and we've certainly got some talent in this country, and I'm really looking forward to working with everyone.
Chris, you've come from a completely different sport in basketball. How is the mood coming into British swimming after what was been well perceived as a difficult Olympic Games?
Yeah, I think, you know, it wasn't an easy place to come into, that's for sure. But equally, I think we've been able to identify plenty of things to do and get our hands dirty quickly. I think we're now starting to look at the gaps and where we can add some value across the whole program. But from my point of view, I'd rather have that than have a situation where there's not much to do.
Yeah, exactly. And we've seen some great racing already, Bill. What are the plans going to be moving forward into Rio?
The plans really are to focus the funding more directly on performance. So we've had a funding cut. I mean, that's not ideal, but it's not a major problem. We're still a well-funded sport. And really it's about value for our money and putting the money that we have got now where the best performers are. So both Chris and I are looking at that as a priority in the next few months, and it'll be a smaller ship, it'll be a tighter ship, but it'll be a performance-funded ship going forwards.
And is that going to be the same for every single year now moving into Rio?
Well, it depends on results. I mean, obviously, if we perform well, then we get funded from UK Sport, and they'll look at that favourably. But definitely, a broad-brush approach does not work if you're looking at winning Olympic medals and World Championship medals. So it's got to be more direct, it's got to be more targeted. So we want to certainly stay with that going forwards.
Thank you very much for your time, guys. Really appreciate it.
Thanks, Ross. Cheers.
So I think the main message we got out of that, that the whole focus is around the next 4 years and what they're looking towards Rio 2016 and working as a real collaboration. Now, in the meantime, we have had the medal ceremonies for the women's 50 metres freestyle, and they've been receiving their medals with the likes of Stephanie Slater taking that gold medal. And it's quite interesting, actually, with Stephanie Slater and her story, because she was down in Swansea in their ITC programme, and now she's moved back up to Preston because she actually got a virus in her left arm, which caused her to become more, well, can't even use her left arm now, and now she's really topping the table in the S8 category.
It's an incredible story, and it just shows you through every low point in your journey, whether you're an athlete or whether you're just a general person that goes on a day-to-day basis, you can kind of come out of that and have a positive effect. So she's obviously a great swimmer anyway, had this virus, became a Paralympic, or certainly a disability swimmer, and now she's doing great things in the pool. So she would much prefer probably to be an able-bodied, but she's making the best out of it, and she's doing really, really well.
It just shows your career never ends if there's an injury like that that really does have an impact on your performance. Now, earlier on this morning, we had the heats, and Bob Ballard followed all the highlights from those heats, so let's see how they all got on.
The penultimate day of action at the British Gas Swimming Championships 2013 started for the able-bodied swimmers with the men's 100 metres freestyle heat. Going in the second of them was the 50 freestyle British record holder Alan Brown, and he wasn't hanging around over two lengths of the Pondsport pool, the American-based swimmer clocking 49.15. Robbie Rennick has already won the 200 and 400 metres freestyle titles here in qualifying times for Barcelona. Here he is having a bash at the 100 and not unexpectedly doing very well at it. He too went sub 50, 49.49 to be precise. Plymouth teenager Ben Proud with a new personal best of 49.89 in second place. There were three heats of the women's 200 metres breaststroke, the fastest of which was the second one, featuring Danielle Lowe and Molly Renshaw. The DaVencio swimmer up against the Beddington one. And it was Lowe who had the fastest finish, not outside her personal best by much. 2:30.09 this morning, compared with 2:29.76. After a thrilling 200 metres breaststroke last night, it was the 100 today. The stars of the four-length event, Jameson and Willis, to come in a moment. But what a week Derby's Adam Peaty is having. Personal bests all over the place, and that hot streak continued in Heat 2, going sub 61 for the first time, 60.75, edging out Ross Murdoch. Now to the Bath Posse, MJ and AW. Not the favoured event for either, Jameson and Willis, but they are competitive animals, as the final heat showed. Neither wanted to yield, so they both finished together with identical times, 61.62. Michael Rock did the heats of the 200 butterfly before pulling out after posting the fastest time. He was quickest too in the heats of the 100 fly, 53.22, about three quarters of a second outside his entry time. He will be back for the semis. Thomas Laxton will be the next fastest in 53.47. No Amy Smith in the women's 100 freestyle. She withdrew this morning, so all the spotlight fell on Britain's number one and British record holder Fran Halsall going in heat two of two. A nice, comfortable, controlled swim for her, 55.20, the fastest time of the morning. The men's 200 backstroke is shaping up to be a cracker of a final on Sunday, and nobody was really showing their hand in the heat. James Gollard went hard over the first 100, then slowed the motor down in the second half of the race, allowing Craig McNally to go full speed ahead for 2:0.71. Last night, Jazz Carlin set the fastest time in the heats in the women's 1500 metres freestyle after a great personal best from Stephen Milne of 15:19.39 in heat one. It was the turn of the quickest of our competitors, not surprisingly, Dan Fogg, our Olympic finalist and open water specialist. Swimming on 61 pace throughout, he was pretty much cruising his way through the second heat to post the best time in the field by 3.5 seconds, 15 minutes 15.95.
So that was all the the updates from this morning's heats, and that means we've got lots of finals to look forward to. Now, we want to get you guys involved with us today, and we've got a bit of a competition that you can be involved with, because here we understand how important training is, and we know all those larger clubs have got all the facilities and equipment they need. So this is actually a prize for those smaller clubs, and we've got the opportunity for you guys to win two pace clocks that were used at the London 2012 facility. So they're quite sought after, and they're something you definitely want to get your hands on. Now, it's quite a simple way for you to win this. All you have to do is tweet us saying why you deserve to win this prize. You have to tweet us hashtag training hard, hashtag BG13, and also fit in why you deserve to win these two pace clocks. And we will read out those best ones later on in the show and find out who are the winners. So you want to get your... Oh, sorry, the winners will be announced tomorrow, so you do not want to miss out on that opportunity. And in the meantime, we did see some presentations taking place. Obviously, we saw, we've already spoken about Stephanie Slater winning her gold medal in the women's 50 metres freestyle. And she's not, this is quite new for her, being in the medal ceremonies for the multi-classifications, but she's very happy. We've also got the likes of Amy Marin there. Are we worried that Amy Marin's doing too much racing here? She's not going to detriment her achievements in Montreal, are we?
She's been fantastic this week, Amy Marin. We had a chat with her earlier and she said, I apologise if I don't swim very quick. I'm in hard training. 4 hours later, she's a second PB, so she's absolutely incredible.
And then we've got the able-bodied finals coming up now. We've got the 100 metres butterfly coming up. Who are we looking out for in that particular race, Ross?
Men's 100 metres butterfly. Gemma Lowe didn't qualify on the 200 metres butterfly, so she's looking to get revenge. She made the qualifying time in the semi-final, but she didn't do it in the final. So it's down to the selectors whether they're going to take her on that. But one way of making sure she's on the plane in Barcelona is by doing it in the 100 metres. So watch out for Gemma Lowe. I think she'll be a class act out on front, and I think she'll get the qualifying time today.
Well, you better get back to your commentary position there, Ross, because the race is about to start. So let's hand over to Bob for the women's 100 metres butterfly.
First able-bodied final of the evening, and here is the 1-8. Of course, 10 in the disabled event, but only 8 in the able-bodied. And you can see Gemma Lowe just missing out on qualification in the 200 butterfly a couple of nights ago. Very determined, very up for this, and feeling very optimistic that she will do the qualifying time in lane 4 in the 100 butterfly. She will have, though, definitely some competition. There's plenty of people around her who want to usurp Gemma Lowe and say that's a big notch on their belt. Georgia Barton, for example, has been improving in leaps and bounds. 60.33, Georgia Barton. There's Gemma Lowe, readied and prepared and steely gazed as she gets ready for her swim. Time that she needs is 58.37. Well, she's already done that time this season. She did it in qualifying, and so we know that in the form she's in, that is well within her compass. Rachel Kelly of Loughborough in 5, Georgia Barton in 3, either side of Gemma Lowe. But this story should all be about Gemma Lowe, because it has ramifications and implications. If she can do it, and hopefully she can, then she will probably be allowed to do the 200 fly as well in Barcelona. So it's really a 2-for-1 deal here for Gemma Lowe.
It certainly is. We saw that she did do the qualification time in the semi-final for the 200, but just not the final. So she's going to want to make revenge for that. And she is going out now in the first 50 metres. She's going to touch first in 27.3. It's actually Rachel Kelly that touches first in lane 5.
11 one-hundredths of a second between Rachel Kelly in first, Gemma Lowe in second, Georgia Barton in third. So Gemma needs to get a move on here, because she's been given a race unexpectedly perhaps by Rachel Kelly.
Gives it a fantastic turn. She's only got 20 metres to go. She's starting to edge out there in the lead ahead of Rachel Kelly, who's just struggling to keep up with Gemma Lowe.
Well, this is all about Gemma Lowe winning this. The question, of course, now is, can she beat 58.37? Yes, she can. 58.02, but she's going to go solo, because Rachel Kelly didn't quite manage it in the end. 58.49 is a new personal best for Rachel, but it is the qualifying time and a relief, a big sigh of relief for Gemma Lowe. 58.02, time achieved. She can think about Barcelona now. and no doubt she'll be doing the 200 metres butterfly when she's there. But it's a cracking swim from Gemma Lowe. You see she's now 7 metres to go. She gets her head down. It's not the greatest of finishes, gliding into the wall. Probably could have gone under 58 seconds there, but still got the qualification time. She'll be in consideration for the World Championship team when it gets announced on Monday.
There's a smile to accompany what she realizes she has just achieved, and that is qualification for another World Championship. She's delighted. And having a quick word with the person who really pushed her all the way, she'll be delighted she was pushed, because that is the time that she requires.
It's going to be a weight off her shoulders, knowing that she had done the qualification time in the semi-final, but it's not the final, and she can't really guarantee that she'll be on the team. But now, having done the two qualification times and one of them in the final, she'll almost be guaranteed to be on the plane to Barcelona.
58.02 for Gemma Lowe. Rachel Kelly, your personal best, 58.49. Tilly Gray in third, and Georgia Barton in fourth. So, as we say, what it means is most likely, so she'll certainly be on the medley relay in the butterfly. That's another thing in addition to everything else. But the likelihood is now that Gemma Lowe will be doing the 200 butterfly and certainly the 100 butterfly, and we'll hear all about it now as she speaks with Andy Sixsmith.
How about it, ladies and gentlemen? What a storming finish from Gemma Lowe. Make some noise. Gemma, magnificent stuff. Under the world qualifying time, what are your thoughts on that?
So happy I managed to do the time tonight. I just didn't want to do what I did in the 200 and go slower tonight. So I think I could hear my mum screaming the last 15 metres, and I was just fighting through the pain. I was like, no. So I'm just glad I got the time.
It always helps to have a bit of mum power in, though, doesn't it? And obviously, you won those two bronzes in Istanbul in 2012 at the World Short Course. How much confidence did that give you in your swimming?
That gave me a lot of confidence, because after the Olympics, I was a bit disappointed with my results. So it's always great to be able to race the world again so quickly, and to get on the podium twice was just amazing for me, and just shows that I'm still motivated to improve.
Well, a fantastic as ever, Gemma Lowe, your 100 metre fly champion.
So that is a massive relief for Gemma Lowe, though, to missing out the 200. She's really bounced back and shown that she can come back in the 100. And subject to confirmation of the team, which will be released next week, she will be on the plane to Barcelona. Because the awkward bit about this competition is they can do the qualification time in the heats and the semi-finals, but they will only accept the qualification time if it is done in the final. And that is what Gemma has just done there, along with 20 other athletes this week. So the team is looking pretty, pretty healthy at the moment. Were you impressed with that swim from Gemma Lowe?
She would have been disappointed after that 200 metres of flying, no doubt about it. But she came back, bounced back really well and qualified for the 100. A little bit disappointed for Rachel Kelly, just missing out just over a tenth of a second from the World Championship qualification time.
So how hard is it, Gemma, for Gemma to adjust from the 200 to the 100? It's quite a, well, not a massive step down, but you've got to change your race plan.
Certainly have, and she's world-class. Gemma is the 200 metres, but also the 100. And we needed her to qualify for the team, because if we could get to select a relay team, a medley relay team, you need one of your best swimmers on that team. So it's good things all around that she's on that team, because not only for herself, but also for the for Great Britain.
Well, well done to Gemma Lowe. It's great to have her on the team, and she's quite an experienced athlete in the lineup. So nice to see that she'll hopefully be on that list. Next race we have up is the men's 200 metres individual medley. So I'm going to hand you back to Bob to see that race unfold.
This should be an absolute cracker. Has all the potential to be a marvellous race, certainly a marvellous finish anyway, between those in the centre lane, Joe Roebuck, Yian Lloyd, Dan Wallace and Roberto Pavoni. Those should be the four scrapping for possibly two paces for Barcelona. Dan Wallace, based in America with Gators in lane four, personal best in the semi-final of 159.80. Roberto Pavoni, 159.82. And Joe Roebuck, 158.16. If you look at that, they're separated by just tenths of seconds. And Yian Lloyd, of course, is getting quicker as well. Personal best, 159.39. But it should, I think, by all probability, be lanes 2, 4 and 5 here. Joe Roebuck, Dan Wallace and Roberto Pavoni. And what are their respective strengths here, Ross? Because amongst there's four different disciplines within the IM. A strong start on butterfly expected from Roebuck, surely.
Yep, definitely. He'll be out there, one of the first people to touch it, 50 metres. Joe's not the best at backstrokes, so he needs to get out really quick on that first length to kind of compensate for his backstroke. You can see that now she's going to touch the wall first. It's actually Ian Lloyd that touches the wall first, 25-6-8, closely followed by Roberto Pavoni, with Joseph Roebuck actually in fourth position. It looked like he touched first.
Well, they all went to the wall together, to be absolutely honest. It's very difficult to differentiate. Luckily, the clock does it for us. Ian Lloyd, Roberto Pavoni, Dan Wallace and Joe Roebuck at the halfway stage. Now, on the butterfly, Roebuck is keeping pace now with Roberto Pavoni, the two blue caps of Loughborough University. Dan Wallace has not made his move yet. Perhaps he's just holding back in lane number four. It is the two Loughborough swimmers out in front, one and two. And in third at the turn was Ian Lloyd.
Both Roberto Pavoni and Joe Roebuck have got to be careful, because Ian Lloyd is one of the best freestylers we have in Britain, and it looks like Ian Lloyd is just on the shoulder of Joe Roebuck as we speak. But Daniel Wallace is having a storming breaststroke leg with 15 metres to go of this leg. He is moving up on the shoulder of Roberto Pavoni.
Roberto Pavoni, as they come into the 150 turn, will have about half a body length advantage over Dan Wallace. Ian Lloyd in third and Joe Roebuck in fourth. It's now down to the freestyle leg, and three of them almost on the line here, Ross.
So yeah, Roberto Pavoni has shown us very, very strong freestyle leg with 25 metres to go. Doesn't look like anybody's going to catch him. He's extending his lead with 15 metres to go. It's now a fight for who's going to come second. It looks like Ian Lloyd is moving to the clear second position.
Ian Lloyd's moving into second. Roberto Pavoni sees the wall coming and hits the wall at 1:58.14. Qualifying time quite comfortably for Pavoni and two for Ian Lloyd. In fact, the top three, indeed, the top four, have all done the qualifying time for Barcelona. Only two can go, and they are Roberto Pavoni, 1:58.14, Ian Lloyd, 1:58.63, Dan Wallace, 1:59. That is a new personal best for him, as it is for Ian Lloyd, and I think as it is for Roberto Pavoni. Yes, massive one. Roberto Pavoni's PB, 1:59.82 before today. He's gone nearly 2 seconds quicker. That's remarkable.
I've been speaking to his coach earlier today at Kev Renshaw, and he said Roberto Pavoni is swimming incredibly well. He's part of the programme that has produced Daniel Fogg and Jack Bonella, and those two guys are swimming incredibly as well. You can see coming into the last 7 metres, Pav got his head down, fast finish from Ian Lloyd, just got the second position, edged out Dan Wallace in third and Joe Roebuck into fourth. But like you say, all those four guys doing the qualification time for the World Championship, but only two can go.
Shows the strength in depth in the men's 200 metres individual medley. In this country, I think we might say the same in the women's a little later on. Pavoni, Lloyd go to Barcelona. Wallace and Roebuck in third and fourth place. Lewis Coleman in fifth, 2:00.50. That's a personal best for him as well. So a lot of very happy people in that. And I know that Mauro, Roberto's dad, is in the vicinity, and no doubt will be having a jig of delight that his boy has made it onto the plane for Barcelona, as indeed has Ian Lloyd. So good news for City of Cardiff, good news for Loughborough University, and good news for Roberto Pavoni with Andy Sixsmith.
Roberto Pavoni, a huge personal best and under the world's qualifying time. What do we think of that, Sheffield? Now, that was an absolutely superb 200 IM for a supposed 400 IM. So where did that come from, Robert?
I had a lot to prove after a disappointing 200 fly a couple of days ago. I really wanted to do well, and I really wanted to be on the team. 200 IM has been one of my favorite events since I was little. I've always concentrated more on the 400, but I knew this year I was ready for a big drop, and I'm glad I did it.
Now, I've heard you've been training extremely hard in Loughborough, but how much confidence does that give you ahead of your 400 IM tomorrow?
Yeah, my coach, Kev Renshaw, is a real slave driver, as everyone knows, but I'm really confident for tomorrow. My 200 was good. My 400 has been just as good all year, so there's no reason why I can't do a good swim tomorrow.
Well, Roberto, you managed to get this huge crowd in Ponds Forge on their feet. Please do it again for your 200 IM champion, Roberto Pavoni.
Well done, Roberto Pavoni. I add him to my list of swimmers, along with Yai and Lloyd, and that, again, that list is growing and growing. The swimmers are running off momentum. And that was an impressive swim by Roberto and Yai, and it was across the whole pool. You couldn't tell who was going to win.
Absolutely cracking. You know, we said we had such a fantastic night last night. That was a great way to start the men's finals tonight. Four guys all going under the qualification time for World Championships in Barcelona. Absolutely brilliant. Roberto Pavoni nearly knocked 2 seconds off his best time. It's just said then that he's working hard with his coach, Kevin Renshaw. He said that he's a real slave driver. They do put the hard yards in, and it's certainly paying.
And you really do have to feel for those that are just missing out, the likes of Dan Wallace and Joe Roebuck. How do they recover from such a setback?
Well, Joe Roebuck only missed the team by 1/100 on the 200 metres butterfly. So to miss out again after going under the qualification time is going to be incredibly hard. He's got the 100 metres fly coming up, so he's going to have to put all his eggs into one basket if he wants to go to the World Championships later on this year.
Well, someone else who has missed out on that qualification time is Lizzie Simmons, who's coming up in the next race, and that's the women's 100 metres backstroke. She's got quite a tough challenge ahead of her because Georgia Davis is leading that pack, and she's still quite a way off the qualification time. But I'm sure Bob will explain that all to you now as I hand over to him to see how that final gets on.
Let's have a look at the lineup for the final of the 100 backstroke for women. And Ellie Simmons is in lane number 6. Georgia Davis is the fastest qualifier either side. Lauren Quigley and Jessica Fuller again. This is a very competitive one, and the qualifying time is a stiff one at 60.43. In the field, only Lizzie Simmons and Georgia Davis have actually achieved that time in the past. So if it's not those two, the others are going to have to go a lot quicker. The best time in the world, 58.84. It'll take 59.6 to get them into the top five. Georgia Davis has done that time before now. Lizzie Simmons has been 59.4. It's a little while ago now, though, and she's maybe not quite in that kind of form here. This is a wide open final of the 100 backstroke. It should be between 3, 4, 5, and 6. Quigley, Davis, Fuller. And what kind of a start has Lizzie Simmons got in lane 6?
Absolutely cracking start. First into the 25 metre mark. Lizzie's going to be disappointed after a 200 backstroke, so expect to see a real angry and gritting determination, a terminated swim from Lizzie Simmons.
First turn, only turn, of course, in the 100 backstroke, and Georgia Davis it is who comes into the wall just ahead of Lauren Quigley, with Jessica Fuller in third, and Lizzie Simmons 29.5. That's a 29.2 split. That's rapid.
That's incredibly quick from Georgia Davis. Georgia Davis is a 50-meter specialist, so you do expect her to be leading at 50 meters, but she's carrying on this pace all the way through to the wall. And there's two girls, Georgia Davis and Lauren Quigley. There's going to be 1 and 2 in this race, and who's going to win?
I think Lauren Quigley might get there before Georgia Davis, and she does! In 1:00.007, she is on her way to Barcelona, as is Georgia Davis. The Stockport Metro posse on the far side go absolutely mental. 6/100ths of a second between first and second. That's all. Lauren Quigley edging out Georgia Davis. They both, though, have got the qualifying time of 1:00.43. Lizzie Simmons, not her day today. 1:00.72. What a finish that was. And Lauren Quigley was pulled from another event this morning so she could concentrate on the 100 backstroke. That's worked wonders, Ross.
It's a cracking race. Coming into the last five here, it was neck and neck. Coming right down onto the touch. And Lauren Quigley just managed to get her hand on the wall before Georgia Davis did. Jessica Fuller up doing a massive PB as well, just over half a second. She's just outside the World Championship qualification time, but it doesn't matter because two girls have already done it, and that is Lauren Quigley and Georgia Davis.
Well, whilst they didn't go sub 1 minute, they won't care because they got the time they require. Both Lauren Quigley of Stockport Metro and Swansea University's Georgia Davis have both achieved the standard required in the 100 backstroke, 60.07, 60.13, and a new personal best for Jessica Fuller. I'm sure Lauren Quigley will have a lot to say for herself, and we'll hear about it now with Andy Sixsmith.
Now, my eardrums, well, they've gone, because I heard a huge amount of support for Lauren Quigley in here. Lauren, huge congratulations on that win. How much did that support help?
Oh,
I couldn't have done that without those guys, so thanks to Stockport and my parents and just everyone, really, just thanks so much.
And it was a magnificent, magnificent time too. Looking forward to those Worlds, should you be selected?
Yeah, definitely. You know, I came just to swim fast, basically, and if I made the team, it was obviously a bonus, so yeah, hopefully.
Ladies and gentlemen, your 100 backstroke female champion, Lauren Quigley.
What a great race there. It was really close between all four of the final swimmers. All of them come within a second of each other, but it was Lauren Quigley who came out on top. But Georgia Davis also did the qualification time. So as I said, they are rocking and rolling here. They are swimming fast, and there's no doubt that our British swimmers are on top form. Now, just a reminder, you can tweet us at BGSC13 with any of your messages of support for our athletes or any questions you have for myself, Bob Ballard or Ross Davenport. And remember, you can also tweet us about wanting to win those time clocks that we said that were used in London 2012 if you hashtag training hard, hashtag at BGSC13. And the reason why you think your club deserves to win those particular time clocks, and I think that'll be a great adding to your training regime. Now, the next race we have up is the 200 metres individual medley. Now, this is quite an exciting one. We have the likes of Siobhan O'Connor, who's received a huge amount of media attention recently. She was a youngster on the team to London 2012 and has got a lot of expectation on her shoulders as she is yet to qualify. So let's find out how she gets on with Bob Ballard in the 200 metres individual medley.
And having chatted to her earlier on, I know she is very, very confident and ready to race. And that's what we want to hear, and that's what we want to see from Siobhan and Marie O'Connor of Bath University. She will have a teammate, Sophie Allen, right next to her, and Sophie Smith of Loughborough University in three. And we better not overlook Amy Wilmot and Danielle Lowe. 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6 here, Ross, are all contenders.
And seven, and a mile lead seven. There's five Olympians in this race, so there's a vast amount of experience. I don't know where this wind's going to come from. You've obviously got Amy Wilmot, who's incredibly quick. Sophie Smith, who's emerging talent and certainly showed she's in great form this week. You've obviously got Siobhan Marie O'Connor in lane four. Sophie Allen, that's swimming incredibly well on the 100 metres breaststroke.
2:10.53 is Siobhan Marie O'Connor's best time of 2013. Fifth in the world is where that places her. She is the red-hot favourite, and she has gone out like a bullet from a gun on the butterfly leg in lane number four, saying, right, catch me if you can.
She's already half her body length up at 25 metres. She's flying down this first length. Only 15 metres to go for. She's going to turn onto her back. The fly is her strong leg, but also breaststroke is incredibly strong. She represented Great Britain at the Olympic Games on 100 metres breaststroke. So if she's up there at 100 metres, expect her to extend that field, extend that lead going into that 150.
27.39, 27.39 at the split. That is rapid from Siobhan Marie O'Connor. Not so happy on the backstroke, but nonetheless, she's given herself so much margin for error over the first 50 that she is leading everywhere. Danielle Lowe was in second at the turn, equal with Sophie Smith, and fourth was Sophie Allen. But you can see who the winner looks like being and who the leader most certainly is at the halfway stage. It is Siobhan Marie O'Connor, who has a gap over second place of over a second. That's held by Danielle Lowe. Third is Sophie Smith, and fourth is Sophie Allen.
It's going to come down to who can come second in this race. It looks like Siobhan Marie O'Connor is going to have this wrapped up. Hannah Miley's got a fantastic breaststroke out there in lane seven. She's moving up now to into about third position. Sophie Allen, we saw win the 100 metres breaststroke, so she's incredibly strong. She's actually beginning to start to catch Siobhan Marie O'Connor, but I don't think she's going to get anywhere nearer going into this 150 metre mark.
Qualifying time for the World Championships is 2:13.14. I think we could take it as road. That time will be beaten by at least one swimmer here, if not two. Now, Siobhan Marie O'Connor, head down, heading for home in lane number four. Sophie Allen is coming right alongside her, though, and it's between these two and four and five.
Yes, right. I said that Siobhan Marie O'Connor looks like she's won it, but she hasn't, because Sophie Allen's in a storming breaststroke and she's flying down the freestyle leg, and she's now about half a body length ahead. Looks like Siobhan Marie O'Connor is going to keep ahead of Hannah Miley, who's out there in lane seven.
The Bath teammates will finish one and two. 2:11.34. That's fine. That's qualification for Sophie Allen. 2:12.12. that's fine. That's qualification. Siobhan Marie O'Connor, she gets the time as well. In third place, it is Hannah Miley who got the time. Sophie Smith, she got the time. The top four, as with the men, the top four and the women all getting the qualifying time. Only two can go, and they are Sophie Allen and Siobhan Marie O'Connor.
Cracking swim. Just like the men's, you had four girls going underneath the qualification time for Barcelona. Absolutely brilliant.
There is our winner. What a performance by Sophie Allen, and indeed by Siobhan Marie O'Connor, who set the pace, led for most of the race, but wasn't able to hold on at the end. But nonetheless, that's fine, that's quick enough, that'll do it for her. Sophie Allen, winner for Bath University. Siobhan Marie O'Connor, also for Bath, in second place. Hannah Murray of Geary in third, and Sophie Smith of Loughborough in fourth place. So all four of those getting the qualification time, but there has to be a winner. There is a winner. That's Sophie Allen of Bath University with Andy Sixsmith now.
Sophie Allen, magnificent winner of that 200. I am thoughts on that.
Obviously, I'm really happy to win and make the team on that, but I'm pretty disappointed with the time, to be honest. What, 10 at least? So.
Okay, Sophie, well, we're going to let you shoot off and grab some water. Ladies and gentlemen, your 200 IM champion, Sophie Allen.
Sophie Allen looked like she put her heart and soul into that race, and we're still disappointed with the time, which is not necessarily a bad thing, because we like to see our British athletes striving for more. And with Siobhan O'Connor coming in second there, hopefully that means that both of them will be on the plane to Barcelona. Now, Sophie Allen almost looked a bit lost for breath there, Ross, didn't she? I mean, the 200 medley, I used to do it, and my teeth used to ache after that race. It was so hard.
Your teeth used to ache?
Yes, I think that's when I knew I'd pushed myself hard enough that my teeth used to ache.
I obviously didn't try hard enough, my teeth never ached, but a fantastic swim. We caught it in the commentary box that we thought that Siobhan Marie O'Connor was going to win it with only 75 metres to go. She was so far. She really went out fast and went so hard for that race. But Sophie Allen just chipped away, and then by the time we got to 25 metres to go, she'd overtaken Siobhan, and she went on to win it. It's a cracking race. All four girls going under the qualification time.
I do remember Siobhan O'Connor doing something very similar to that in London, which meant that she didn't make the time at the first trials, because she just went out like a bullet and then didn't come back. She's still lacking that little bit of experience, isn't she?
Yeah, but she's only, I think, 16 years of age still, so she's learning each time she swims, and she probably just needs to pace it a little bit different. But if that's the way that she swims best, that's what she's got to do. But you can see now she's still got half a body length, and she started, you can see the difference in stroke rate. Siobhan Marie O'Connor's got a lot lower stroke rate than Sophie Allen, and that's what took her through the 25 metres, gained that momentum as we come down to the last 5 metres. Sophie Allen was a clear winner.
Yeah, and do you think them being teammates is a good thing, or maybe has a bit of a, they know what each other can do?
I think it's going to be a good thing. We saw in the breaststroke, in terms of Andrew Willis and Michael Jameson, they're pushing each other every single day. It's going to be great for Great Britain if them two are pushing each other in training every single day.
Absolutely. Well, fourth place in that race was Sophie Smith, and we caught up with her coach a little bit earlier, Kev Renshaw, and Ross chatted to him about his hopes and expectations for his swimmers at the meet and in the future.
Good evening. I'm here with Kevin Renshaw, head of the British Gas ITC in Loughborough. Coached Daniel Fogg, who we've seen had an incredible week this week. Also coached David Davis to an Olympic silver medal in the 10K. Kev, we've seen Daniel have an incredible week this week. What have you been doing differently for previous years?
Because he was targeting two events, with the 1500 and the 10K in London, we decided that we'd had to really change the recipe of what we was doing. So we split the year into two halves. First part of the year was really getting the base work down for the 10K. So we did a hell of a lot of high volume work, short rest, some really, really big pieces of work, going 6 kilometre sets, single sets of work. Then after Christmas, we then started to change the focus into high intensity, high speed swimming.
Seen that this week that he's in immaculate condition. Physically, he looks in the best shape he's ever been. Last year, we talked about being a breakthrough year. He was fifth at the London Olympic Games in the 10K. Next year, there's no 10K in international, so what's going to be the focus going into Commonwealth year?
Well, it will be the Commonwealth Games, and it's probably going to be the watershed moment for him. we think that from that point on, he's probably then going to be focused in on the 10K. But it's a good year for that. Commonwealth, he got a bronze medal last time around. You know, we obviously think we can go a little bit better than that this time next year. But there's also a European Championships as well that we've got to talk with Bill and whoever takes over the open water side of things as well about maybe doing the open water at the European Championships straight after Glasgow.
So we've already seen him swimming really well this week. He's qualified for the 400, the 800, potentially going to qualify for the 1500 and the 10K. How are you going to manage that over the next 4 weeks going into Barcelona?
Well, we'll be having a tough, long conversation tomorrow night after the 1500.
And Kev, you've been part of the ITC now for a good 5 years or so. How have you seen the programme evolve over those 5 years?
It's changed a lot. As you know, Ross, I came in, helped coach yourself when back in 2005. We've had, at that point, we had Ian Turner, Ben Titley and myself as the coaching staff. And Ian moved on to Pastures New and Ben and myself in the road up to London. And now Ben's moved on and James Gibson's come in and brought in a totally different dynamic to the programme. And it's very, very exciting times ahead for us.
And are you able to learn from each of these coaches?
Oh, absolutely. I've had a fantastic time in Loughborough because, as well as that, we've had people like Ian Armiger there, who is a real team man as well, and he brought so much to Loughborough. You know, the setup there is fantastic, and very largely down to Ian.
Thank you very much for your time, Kev. Good luck for the future, and good luck for the rest of this week.
Thanks very much.
Great to hear from Kev Renshaw. And as you can see, we've got the lineup for the men's 100 metres semi-final coming up. So I'm going to hand you over to Bob, ready to see how that race unfolds.
Thanks very much, Eddie. Kate, very quickly we'll run you through the main protagonists here. Robbie Rennick in 4, James Dizzy-May in 5, and Jack Scott maybe going to creep in there in lane 2. Semi-final number 1 of the men's 100 metres freestyle. Shouldn't disregard the man who set a personal best to make this semi-final in lane 3 from City of Manchester Aquatics, Daniel Briggs. But Robbie Rennick already with the 400 earlier in the week and the 200 under his belt, going for the 100. Probably his lesser favourite event, but he set a personal best this morning, Ross.
Yeah, he's flying this week, Robbie. He's not even fully tapered, so he's going to go out there extremely quick, but he's going to come back even quicker. He's going to be one of the fittest guys in this field, and he turns... Oh, no, James Dizzy-Mays turns first in 23.9. So watch out for Robbie to come storming back in the second 50.
Well, we'd like to see quite a few of these swimmers, if possible, go sub 50. Then we know we're on the right road, because this is where they need to be posting fast times. Robbie Rennick against James Dizzy-May. Robbie Rennick has now got the better of the American-based swimmer, and is Robbie Rennick is going to come to the wall first and stop the clock at 49.63. Not as fast as he went this morning. Dizzy-May at 50.10. He hasn't quite cracked the 50-second barrier. In third place is Jack Scott, and in fourth, it is Carl Morgan of Nova Centurion. That's the 1, 2, 3, 4. They'll all hope to make it through, but not a rapid semi-final, really.
No, it's not. You tend to see that in the semi-finals in the 100-metre freestyle, especially in Britain, that they don't swim as quick as they do in the morning. But this looked an incredibly easy, controlled race from Robbie. He is flying this week. He's won the 400, he's won the 200, and now he's through to the final in the 100. You can see him there, he doesn't hardly look out of breath. So fantastic swim from Robbie, 49.63, over a half second behind James Dizzy-May, 50.1.
And Carl Morgan, and poor old Daniel Briggs, who I was talking up there, sadly fell away into eighth place, but that's the top four. Hopefully we'll be in that final tomorrow night. Semi-final number 2, and this is where the big guns are. Very much where the fast men of the week are. We've seen already what Adam Brown can do. He is now the new British record holder in the 50. And Ben Proud of Plymouth Leander, a new personal best for him in the heats this morning of 59.8. Now let's get the full list of semi-final number 2 of the 100 metres freestyle. Here they come, and they'll be going very shortly. Andrew Bushell, Loughborough in one, Craig Gibbons and Wickham now in two, but it is going to be four, five, and possibly six in the mix at the end. All swimmers who've gone sub 49 or thereabouts. Adam Brown, Ben Proud, and Grant Turner. This could be a real shoot-up between four, five, and six.
Adam Brown, British record holder, as you said, on the 50 metres from 2 days ago. Ben Proud, British record holder on the 50 metres butterfly. And just behind Adam Brown on that 50 metres freestyle. So expect these two guys to go out like absolute guns and really be out there at 50 metres. Grant Turner just off it this morning in the heats, but didn't really have to do his best to make this semi-final, so expect something from him. So four, five, and six, expect that's where the win will come from.
Just got to look at Adam Brown as he prepares. There's Ben Proud as he gets ready for another big race. He's had loads this week. 49.89, new personal best this morning. Adam Brown, 48.15 is his personal best. 49.15, which is faster in the heats than he actually went in the final of the Olympic qualifying last year in London. So we know he's in good form. We certainly know Ben Proud's in good form. Not quite sure about Grant Turner yet, although Turner is trying to set the pace in lane six.
Grant's being trained by James Gibson, former 50-meter breaststroke world champion. And it looks like it's going to be Adam Brown that turns first, 23.24. That's over half a second quicker than semi-final number one.
Yeah, this should be rapid. Hopefully we'll get three swimmers at least under 50 seconds, though. They're easing up a bit, it's got to be said. Adam Brown is not going hell for leather here. He wants to keep something in reserve, but that's a good, long, loping stroke we're seeing from Adam Brown. This is still going to be very quick, you know. 48.99 for Adam Brown. That's good, very good. Ben Proud, 49.66, a new personal best by 0.2 of a second for him. Third goes to Grant Turner, 50.35. He might be a little bit disappointed with that, but I'm sure he will be. And fourth to Aaron Rickus of Plymouth. But that time again, the winning time, 48.99 for Adam Brown. He did a 49.15 this morning, so he's taken nearly 0.2 of a second off the time, and he didn't seem to be overextending himself over the last 25.
No, it looked like he was all in for about 50 metres, then he started to lengthen that stroke out, really slowed his stroke rate down. As you can see, he's coming into the last 5 metres. He just glides into the wall, head up. That's not how you finish 100 metres freestyle, but that just shows you how much he's got left in the tank. And tomorrow we could expect big things if he doesn't tighten up. That's the worst thing you can do, especially on a 100 metres, is you get tense, you get rush it too much, and then your time actually gets slower because you're using a lot of energy, just wasting it through nervous energy or just wasting it away.
48.99, though, the winning time for Adam Brown. Ben Proud in second, Grant Turner in third, and fourth to Aaron Rickhouse. The final, of course, of the 103 is tomorrow night.
As Bob said, the final for the 100 metres freestyle will be tomorrow night, and they are the fastest men in the pool. And Robbie Renwick, he does not fail to impress. Not only has he qualified in the 400 metres freestyle, the 200 metre freestyle, but if it all goes well tomorrow night, he will also be in the 100 metres freestyle, and that's quite an incredible achievement to be able to switch across all those distances. And you know, he may even go for 51 year the way he's going. Also in that mix is James Disney May, which I think is an incredible surname. I'd love to have a surname like that. Quite showcase there. But also in there we have Adam Brown and Ben Proud, who are in the 50 lineup as well. So great speed coming up. But there's more semi-finals coming your way, and we have the women's 200 metres breaststroke semi-finals coming up. So back over to Bob to see who's in that race.
Let's give you the full list then, shall we, of all the swimmers in the 200 breaststroke. And Stacey Tadd, who won the 50 last night. And look at Hannah Miley's back again for more. She goes in lane number five. But Stacey Tadd, with all that heat and all that speed from yesterday in the 50, is going now in the 200.
She did the interview after her 50 metres came out and she won it, and she was as surprised as everybody else. She didn't expect to go into that 50 metres and win. She is a 200 metre specialist, so to drop down and to win the 50 metres is remarkable. So expect Stacey, incredibly fit individual.
Take your mark.
Well, she showed last night with a personal best and a big personal best as well that she has the speed over 50 now. She's more renowned for the 200. Her best time is 2:26. Now, I am told by those who've been observing her fairly closely recently, they think she can do a 2:24 or a 2:25 here. She is in that kind of form, Ross.
That's incredible. She wasn't sure whether to carry on after the London Olympic Games. She took a long time out. Then she actually decided that she was going to get back in. I think she really did contemplate retiring from the sport, but thankfully she hasn't. She does turn first in 33.71. Actually, she's second in 33.71 behind Georgia Evans, who we saw in the 100 metres breaststroke earlier on in the week.
Yeah, she does a lot this week and has done a lot, Georgina Evans. 33.68, you mentioned, 3/100ths of a second ahead of Stacey Tadd. But Stacey Tadd generally comes strong in leg number two and right on cue. Where's she coming? She's coming strong in the second length, and she's taking along with her Hannah Wiley in lane number five, and also Rebecca Swales of Preston in six. But down below us in two, Georgina Evans still going well, and she will be in second place at the turn behind Stacey Tadd. 1:11.55, the split time for Stacey. Second, Georgina Evans. Third is Hannah Miley. And fourth, Rebecca Swales.
We've already seen Hannah from the 200 metres medley final of just over 20 minutes ago, so she's back in the pool. She's always a multi-eventer. She's always in and out of the pool, loves racing. But on this occasion, it looks like Stacey Tadd's going to get the better of her. She's now opening for the lead of around about 4 to 5 metres as we come into the final turn and only one length to go.
Yeah, my spies tell me that she is in cracking form right now. She showed it in the 50. She did pretty well in the 100. And this is the best event, the 200. And Stacey Tadd is leading all comers here. They're not going to catch her. Hannah Miley is going to try all she can to catch her. She's not going to get there. Georgina Evans is not going to get there, hard though she tries. This is all about Stacey Tadd trying to set a really impressive time in the semi-final, with, of course, one more to come after this, featuring the likes of Melly Renshaw and Rachel Solway and Danielle Lowe. But Stacey Tadd, having won the 50, having done pretty well in the 100, is going to set a decent marker here for the first semi-final of the 200 breaststroke. Stops the clock at 2:28.39. That's some 3 seconds quicker than she went in qualification this morning. Hannah Miley in second, 2:30.23, just outside her season's best. Third, Georgina Evans, and that's a season's best for her in third place. And fourth going to Olivia White of the City of Leeds, and that will be an impressive time by her standards.
It's incredibly easy as we're watching the replay. She is about 1.5 seconds outside the consideration mark for the World Championship, so she's going to have to go a lot quicker in the final tomorrow night if she wants to be on the plane going to Barcelona. But incredibly smooth swim from Stacey, and she'll be in the final tomorrow night.
Yeah, she needs to improve to 2:26.81 for the qualification tomorrow night. Stacey Tadd in first, Hannah Miley in second, Georgina Evans, Olivia White. All of them should hopefully progress through to the final tomorrow night.
Molly Renshaw in heat number two. Saw her win at the British Gas International Meet in Leeds earlier on this year. She narrowly missed making the Olympic team last year. She did the qualification time at the wrong meet, and as in the selection policy, she wasn't able to go. So she was good enough to go, but she did it at the wrong time of the year, at the wrong place, and she wasn't able to represent the country at home Olympic Games.
Here she is, in lane number four, with Rachel Solway and Danielle Lowe either side of her. Molly Renshaw, fastest qualifier from DaVinci this morning. Well, the rest of the world has moved on. We have Rikke Pettersson doing 2:20.53. Can you believe that? Fastest time in the world. She leads the world by over 2.5 seconds. That's an extraordinary time, the leader of the all-comers for this year. And then everybody kind of in the 2:23, 2:24 bracket. We haven't seen a 2:24 swimmer in this country, Ross, since Kirsty Balfour.
Yeah, that's going back some years. Set that record around about the 2006 time. So Stacey's pushed it. Stacey's got close to that, but nobody has really got down to 2:24 for a long time.
Molly Renshaw's best time is 2:26.81. She hasn't got close to that this season. 2:28.25 is Molly's best in 2013. Danielle Lowe closing in on her best, and Rachel Solway, 2:32. So they're all around the 2:30 mark. Sophie Taylor's done a 2:28 from Leeds in lane six. Didn't quite swim as well as she would have liked this morning with a 2:34. But because of the way the qualification works here, not everybody is busting a gut in the heat. And sometimes people just step it up big time in the semi-finals.
If we saw that last night in the men's 200 metres breaststroke with Michael Jameson, we didn't know what kind of form he was in. We were contemplating whether he was going to win the race, and he came up and absolutely smashed his performance, got the world qualification time, got the number one time in the world. So these swimmers are probably just going to go through the motions. If they know they can make the final, they're going to keep all their energy in reserve and just play all their cards out on the deck tomorrow.
Sophie Taylor led at the 50 split, Molly Renshaw in second place, Hayley Monteith of Edinburgh University in third, and they are grouped pretty closely together here. Renshaw in four, Danielle Lowe in five, Sophie Taylor in six, and we'll keep an eye on Hayley Monteith in seven, who's just slipped back on the place. She had a very good first 50, but not quite a good second 50. And that's led the way to Molly Renshaw taking over at the front of the field from Danielle Lowe. Sophie Taylor has now moved back into third place, and Rachel Wilson is in fourth. Let's see whether we can get some times in and around the 2:30 mark, which will progress them to the final.
Molly's got a really long, smooth stroke. You see that now? It just takes about 3 meters per stroke, which is great distance per stroke. So she's coming up now for the final turn. She's going to head home with only one length to go and clear 4 meters in front.
Yeah, big margin between first and second. In terms of time, it's 1.1 seconds between first and second. Sophie Taylor in second place. Third place is Danielle Lowe, and Rachel Solway of Loughborough is in fourth. Remember, top eight times will progress through to the final tomorrow night. Don't think there's too much down. Molly Renshaw is going to be amongst those eight because she has led the field for the majority of this 200 breaststroke. Coming back quite strongly now is Sophie Taylor in sixth. Danielle Lowe wanting to be in the mix as well, but Molly Renshaw will be closing in on a decent time, a very decent time, in the second semi-final as she stops the clock at 2:27.82. Second place going to Sophie Taylor of Leeds, 2:28.98. And third from Bevington, Danielle Lowe, 2:29.96. So we've got three swimmers there under 2:30.
Molly posted a time that was half a second quicker than the winner of semi-final number one. So it's going to be a cracking race tomorrow between Stacey Tadd and Molly Renshaw. Both got to go considerably quicker. Stacey got to go 1.5 seconds quicker, and Molly's got to go a second quicker if they want to be considered for the World Championship team.
Well, we think both Molly and Stacey are in the kind of form and are capable of doing that time tomorrow night in the final. That, of course, you will see live with us here from Ponds Forge on the final evening of finals. All of them will be finals. A few of them are splash and dash. And we'll also have a 1500 meters final for men as well. There's a result of semi-final number two. Molly Renshaw, Sophie Taylor, Danielle Lowe and Rachel Solway are the 1, 2, 3, 4, three of them under 2:30. Molly Renshaw's winning time, 2:27.82.
And we will review that 200 metres breaststroke race very soon, but I've just picked up on one of our Twitter feed messages, and I think it's a real standout message of the kind of swimming we're seeing here this week. It's from Jason Tate. I'm just having a look at my Twitter feed right now, and it says, "At British Swimming, watching people swim faster than I could ever do, even with a motor strapped to me, hashtag respect." And I think I've got to give them that kind of respect as well, because the times we are seeing here are really incredible, and I'm very proud to have our swimmers doing so well here at the competition. Now, we just saw the 200 metres breaststroke there, and as Bob and Ross did say, it's going to be a great race tomorrow at the finals, and they will be competing Stacey Tadd v Molly Renshaw to see if both of them can do the qualification time. Now, if you were going to be putting your money on either two of those swimmers, if any of them, who would you be going for, Ross?
The women's 200 metres breaststroke, Stacey Tadd looked really strong, but so did Molly Renshaw.
it's going to be a close one. It's only half a second separating them from the semi-final, so it's going to be... I'm going to stick my neck out. Molly Renshaw's from Derby, so am I, so I'm going to back Molly Renshaw for tomorrow night.
Because we can't really call you an expert in breaststroke, can we? Because I'm pretty sure I did beat you over 50 metres at breaststroke today, and I think even gave you a head start, Ross. It's not your strongest stroke, is it?
It certainly isn't. It's renowned in the British team that I've probably got one of the worst breaststrokes, so just because you beat me doesn't mean you're good at breaststroke.
Yeah, well, we'll let you off there, Ross. But yeah, I think I'd go with Stacey Tadd. But we've got a medal ceremony going on now, and it's the women's 100 metres backstroke there. And we have the three top performers of that particular race. We've got Jessica Fuller Love there. Georgia Davis probably wasn't expecting to be in the silver medal position, was she, Ross? Maybe wanting to be on top form?
Yeah, that's right. Georgia Davis would have obviously wanted to go there and win the event. We've seen Lizzie Simmons miss out on the backstroke. She won the 200 metres backstroke, but she missed out on the qualification time. And in this event, she actually came fourth. So she's not going to be on the plane going to Barcelona, which is a big surprise. She was one of our standout swimmers in the 200 metres backstroke last year at the London Olympic Games. She was a finalist over the 200 metres, so she's not going to be a member of the team. So it's now down to one of these girls to step up and certainly take on that backstroke mantle.
She's one of those athletes that you almost expect to be on the team, and she's not, along with a couple of others that we have here today. But let's focus on Lauren Quigley. She had incredible support from her Stockport Metro teammates. They must be over the moon to have her on the team. Is that her first international?
It's her first senior international, going to Barcelona, the World Championships. It's a great way to start your international career, your senior international career. But Stockport have always had a great team ethic behind them. They're always cheering, they're always really supportive of their swimmers, and they've lost their ITC funding.
Yes.
So the way they bounce back is absolutely brilliant. Seeing Lauren Quigley win the 100 metres backstroke. Sophie Allen used to train there, now has moved to University of Bath. But you know, they've got great swimmers coming through, and they've also produced many great swimmers over the years.
So we now have the women's 200 metres individual medley medal ceremonies there. And Hannah Miley, she seems to have been doing so much. She's already done the 200 medley. She's just done the 200 metres breaststroke, and she's got back up to the podium. That girl never stops.
She never stops. She did a 200 free the other night as well. She's won this event for many years, over the many years in Britain. So this is a bit of a changing of the guard in terms of the 200 IM. Sophie Allen had a fantastic race, overhauling Siobhan Marie O'Connor right at the end. She's had a brilliant week, Sophie, winning the 100 metres breaststroke. But Hannah did qualify for the 400 metres IM, so she'll be representing Great Britain in that event. And Sophie, looks like she's laughing there, just realised she's on camera.
Yeah, she looks like she's recovered, actually, because after a race in her interview, she was gasping for breath and looked like she was about to pass out. So it's great to see she's fully recovered, because like we've said with Hannah, she's bouncing back to all these races. What kind of recovery are they going through to ensure that they are in the best possible form for each of their races?
Well, somebody like Hannah, you know, you've got to recover the best possible you can, because she's got so many events coming up. She'll be busy tomorrow doing something else as well. So as soon as they finish racing, they have to get into the pool behind me, swim down pool, and get rid of all the lactic acid out of their body. Probably take a protein shake, something to eat, so that the body is fully recovered so they can go again for the next race.
Because it's amazing, they're doing back-to-back races. It's almost like they can't get enough of it. And do you think the more race preparation they can get, the better?
I think so. A competition like this, as long as it doesn't hinder them too much. So if they do qualify for the World Championships or an Olympic Games, and then they only do one event, then everything becomes a lot easier. So if they do lots of events here and they can still post world-class times like Hannah Miley is, when she goes to the World Championships and just focus on the 400 medley, everything will become a lot more simple.
Well, you're talking about Smiley Miley. We have got her in this review of the 200 metres breaststroke. Not quite on Stacey Tadd's shoulder. She was let her get away from her there, but Stacey's long, languishing stroke really did put a solid performance. And I think one thing I know about Stacey is she never puts everything out on the line in the first couple of races. She will wait until that final. She's not going to waste any energy. Do you think Molly Renshaw was putting it all out there, or has she got more to come?
No, I think both these girls have really long, smooth strokes, and it looked effortless for them to get into this final tomorrow night. So expect a real close final, but I'm still sticking with Molly that she's going to win. She won in the British Gas International meet early on in the year. It was the first time she's actually beat Stacey Tadd, so that was a big weight off her shoulders that she actually can compete against the best of Britain and take them on and win. So I'm sticking my neck on the line. I'm going to say Molly's going to win tomorrow.
And from one breaststroke race to another, we have the men's 100 metres breaststroke coming up. Adam Peaty seems to be the fastest qualifier. Any threats for him?
Adam Peaty's also from Derby. He's been doing great things. He came second in the 50 metres. He also qualified for the final in the 200. This is his preferred event. Fastest qualifier through to tonight's semi-final. He's still young. He's still very immature in terms of physically. He can develop a lot more. So expect great things for him. Not even tomorrow, but also going into the next 4 years.
Well, straight over to you, Bob, for that semi-final.
Thank you, Ross Davenport, on behalf of the Derby Tourist Board. And we will see semi-final number one of the 100 breaststroke containing Ross Murdoch, who set a new personal best earlier this year. Didn't quite match it this morning. Michael Jameson going in lane five, the 200 breaststroke champion from yesterday, and Joseph Wellstead in three. Now, Murdoch against Jameson, two Scots going head-to-head here. Ross Murdoch's had a great year. New 50 breaststroke champion in Scotland, Scottish record holder. Michael Jameson, of course, is a man who has gone sub 60 seconds in this race. Very few Brits have done that. That should be Jameson at the turn, you would think, but it's not. Ross Murdoch turns in first place. Jamie Graham, another Scot, in second place. And Michael Jameson has some work to do, but here comes the work he needs to do in five. But I'll tell you what, Ross Murdoch's having an absolute stormer here and might well beat Michael Jameson.
Absolutely storming leg from Ross Murdoch. He's only got 10 metres to go, and he's probably about a metre and a half up on Michael Jameson. Michael Jameson's not going to catch this in the final 5 metres.
Wow, is he going to beat the minute, Barry? Oh, 1/100th outside of it. 1:00.01 for Ross Murdoch. Personal best by over half a second for him. Michael Jameson in second, and third place going to Jamie Graham. I thought we were going to see our first sub-minute swim there. We were so, so close. Ross can do it when it really matters, I suppose, in the final tomorrow night. But 60.01, Jameson second, Graham in third, and Joseph Wellstead of Stirling, the Scottish quartet there, 1, 2, 3, 4.
Absolutely crazy. Something about Scotland and breaststroke, especially breaststroke men, seem to have a history of just producing breaststrokers, world-class breaststrokers, Olympic medalists. But that was a fantastic swim from Ross Murdoch. You see how pleased he was with that swim. He's going to be slightly disappointed not to go under that magical minute barrier mark for 100 metres breaststroke.
Wow. What a start that is in the 100 breaststroke. And I think we are going to see surely our first sub 60 on the second semi-final, with the first one nearly. 60.01, Jameson second, Graham in third, Wellstead in third. Russell Smith will have to hang on and hope a 1:02.20. I think he might be unlucky. This is going to be quick.
That was the fifth fastest time this year for Ross Murdoch, and only 1/100 from the fourth fastest time. So, and only 1/100 after that from third. So it's incredibly tight in the top five in the world. And if he can go under that minute barrier mark tomorrow, he'll probably go around about third fastest in the world this year.
Look at that. Two through to six. Benson, Steeples, P.T. Willis and Holderness. How stacked do you want it?
Andrew Willis had a fantastic 200 metres breaststroke last night. He isn't renowned to be a 200 metre, so this is stepping down for him. Adam Peaty's been brilliant all week. 200 metres was a PB for him, a massive PB for him. So was the 50. It's just 2-6. Any of these guys can win this semi-final.
Right, let's have a look and see how this develops. Craig Benson, semi-finalist at the Olympics last year in lane two. Christopher Steeples, who's improving every single swim, it seems, from City of Manchester Aquatic in three. Adam Peaty, who has set a personal best in every single race he has done this week in every single competition. Let's see if he can carry that on. I'm sure he will. Andrew Willis, yesterday second and qualifying for Barcelona in the 200. And Rob Holderness, I think, has got a little bit left in the tank here as well. They're all just kind of sizing each other up this morning. Nobody really going for broke, and they're going to have to now because they've got to get a top eight time. And Andrew Willis into his stroke very early.
Looked like Chris Steeples had the best start, going through first in the first 25 metres. They're coming up to the first turn. Adam Peaty is now starting to come through in lane four.
First 50 turn, we'll get an idea of what the times are like. We have joint leaders at the turn. Adam Peaty and Christopher Steeples, followed by Andrew Willis. Craig Benson yet to make his move, really, in lane number number two, and fifth is Mark Talley. This is going to change quite a bit over the last 25.
About 0.2 slower than the first semi-final. Let's see if they can catch up that time over the second 50 metres. But it looks like Adam Peters coming through now. He's just edging out ahead from Chris Steeples. And Andrew Willis is probably in about fourth position.
1:00.075, a personal best for Adam Peaty. Forget that. It's 1:00.016 now. Second place, Christopher Steeples. Third to Rob Holderness. Fourth to Craig Benson. And Andrew Willis will, I think, just about make the final on 1:01.39. We'll have to wait for confirmation of that when the board revolves. But it is definitely a win for Adam Peaty and a new personal best at 60.16.
That's incredible swim from Adam. He's already said already, Bob, every time he's got in the pool this week, he has set a PB, and he's gone and smashed it yet again by over half a second. So it'd be 1 and 2 tomorrow, being separated by 15/100 a second. It's going to come down to who can hold their nerve, who's going to win that event tomorrow night.
Andrew Willis does get through in seventh place. Jamie Graham gets the final slot in the final for tomorrow night. That was rapid from Adam Peaty, as fast as he has ever been, and once again a personal best. Chris Steeples in second, Rob Holderness third, Craig Benson in fourth, and Andrew Willits in fifth, and he makes it through to the final as well.
So the breaststroke tides are changing, and maybe the lads that we were expecting to be at the top of the semi-final list were not quite there. If we have a look at some of the replays of those races, because both of them were brilliant races, we have the likes of Ross Murdoch and Adam Peaty knocking off the likes of Michael Jameson and Andrew Willis, which is quite a different expectation, because we expect those top lads from the 200 to be able to transfer across the 100, but it just keeps it that little bit more competitive. And while we wait for those highlights to come up, just a reminder that you can tweet us, but I think we do have the replays here, so let's have a look. There's the likes of Ross Murdoch and beating Michael Jameson. I think Scottish swimmers will be very pleased to see that, because both their Scottish swimmers, when it comes to Glasgow 2014 Commonwealth Games next year, are going to be in great positions to be taking some medals for Scottish swimming. And he was over the moon with that, Ross Murdoch. I think as Ross Davenport did say, that was a top five time in the world. And then Adam Peaty stepping up here. He'd already qualified for the world's team in the 50 metres breaststroke, but he's stepped up to the 100 as well and transferred that speed into 100 metres. So, oh, we will rock you there. Brilliant support for our swimmers, and that's what we'd like to see. But we are heading straight over to our next semi-final, which is the men's 100 metres butterfly. Over to you, Bob.
Thomas Laxton of Loughborough was the fastest qualifier in this semi-final. Either side are Loughborough swimmers 2, James Doolan in 3, Adam Barrett in 5, and Joe Roebuck, back after the disappointment of the 200 IM earlier in the session, goes in lane 2 in the 100 fly.
This is Joe's last chance to qualify for the World Championship team. Narrowly missed out by 1/100 of a second on the 200 metres butterfly. Got the qualification time on the 200 medley, but came fourth. This is his last chance, but it is now lane 4. Thomas Laxton from Loughborough that's leading out this field in the first 50 metres.
Did his personal best in the heats this morning, 53.47 for Thomas Laxton, but beaten to the touch there by 11/100 of a second by Adam Barrett. So this is a Loughborough loving, if you like, Ross.
It certainly is. These two guys going head to head with only just over 15 metres to go, stroke for stroke.
Absolutely together. Who wants it more? They both want it desperately. Adam Barrett, I think, on the touch, but it's one of those that's going to have to be sorted out by the scoreboard. And Adam Barrett gets it, 52.87 for him. Brand new PB. Thomas Laxton, 53 seconds dead. Brand new PB. Joe Roebuck sneaking in to third place, 53.11, just outside his personal best. And James Doolan of Loughborough, so 1-2-4 for Loughborough, 53.68 for James Doolan.
Cracking swim from Adam Barrett, new PB. He's going to have to go a smidgen quicker if he wants to be considered for that World Championship team. The qualifying time is 52.22, so he's going to have to drop around about half a second if he wants to be considered for the team. Interesting to see Michael Rock in this second semi-final. He did the heats of the 200 metres butterfly, but pulled out to the semi-final to concentrate on this race. So He obviously thinks the 100 is his best chance of making the team, but he's going to be up against the likes of Anthony James, also Rebecca Addington's fiance Harry Needs goes in lane 6.
He is the British record holder as well, Michael Rock. Let's see the confirmed results on the first one. Adam Barrett, 52.87. Thomas Laxton in second, and Joe Roebuck finishing in third. And the 1-8 for the 100 butterfly semi-final number 2 looks like this. Anthony James represented Great Britain at the Olympics last time round. Michael Rock likewise. Tim, that's Braxton Tim in lane 5, who did a personal best this morning. Harry Needs, the husband-to-be of Rebecca Addington.
Expect to see Anthony James turn first at the first 50 metres, but Michael Rock, with that 200 metres endurance, expect to start him to reel him in going down the final 50.
Looking at the British record holder, Michael Rock, 51.49 is that time, although I have him down as 51.41 on my sheet here, but it's around that time for a British record. And he certainly is the British record holder. Now, Anthony James will be looking to step up his swim for this morning. Braxton Tim, as I say, season's best and a personal best, 53.51. And, well, four of them pretty much in the line, but the bouncing Michael Rock in lane number 4 is showing them the way to go.
Can't separate the first two swimmers, which are Anthony James and Michael Rock. We have to look at the scoreboard to see who touches the wall first. And it is Anthony James in 24.42 ahead of Michael Rock in 24.60.
Great noise here at Bonds Forge. Everybody trying to support their swimmer. Of course, Braxton Tim, City of Sheffield, is in lane number 5. But Michael Rock showing he still has it, doing his law degree. Braxton Tim's trying to keep with him, as is Anthony James. But this is Michael Rock leading them through a procession for the City of Liverpool swimmer, who is going to touch now in 51.91, Michael Rock. That will be a qualifying time if he does it in the final tomorrow night for Barcelona. Anthony James, 52.72. And Braxton Tim has done a 53.06 in third. Harry Needs in fourth, 54.55. That was rapid, it was quick, and they will rock you, and he rocked them.
Yeah, cracking swim from Michael. Underneath that consideration time for the world's team, he didn't panic. Anthony James went out about 0.2 quicker, just the lane below him, but he kept control, he kept calm, and just reeled him in and then overtook him. See, now he's coming into the last 5 metres, around about 2 metres ahead, touching the wall in 51.91. So under the qualification time, just outside his PB, he'll be expecting to go a lot quicker tomorrow night.
Sam Horrocks takes the last position. Harry Needs missing out in ninth place. He will hope that somebody withdraws for the final tomorrow, but he's not going to be back if they don't. And here comes the result of semi-final number 2 of the men's 100 metres butterfly. Michael Rock, fastest by far, 51.91. Anthony James in second, Braxton Tim third. Harry Needs, though, fourth though he was, not getting through to the final.
It's going to be a cracking final tomorrow night. Michael Rock's going to be first in lane 4, closely followed by Anthony James and the likes of Joe Roebuck. We've always spoke about he's his last chance to qualify tomorrow.
We will rock you indeed. What a brilliant swim from Michael Rock. And the crowd is buzzing here. We really are very excited about what we're seeing in front of us. And that fits very nicely with one of the tweets we received. Thank you very much to Judith Buck. I'm just having a look at our stream now. It says, let's have a Mexican wave for all those following the live broadcast. Now, I would join in with you, Judith, but I would look a little bit silly on my own. But I hope you all doing it at home, in your living rooms, wherever you are watching this live broadcast. And that is what we like to see, you supporting our swimmers. Another great tweet we've got is from Harvey Folshaw. These swimmers, he says, these swimmers swim and then swim some more until they have battery acid pumping through their veins. These swimmers really do love the atmosphere. They love swimming and they love winning and doing personal best times, and that is what we are seeing here this week. Now, we've got another semi-final coming up for you. They are coming thick and fast, and that final is the women's 100 metres freestyle. Over to you, Bob.
That's what they call me and Ross, thick and fast, apparently.
I'm too tired from doing the Mexican wave.
I'll give you a wave, not sure about the Mexican bit.
Take your mark.
Caitlin McClatchy going in lane three for Edinburgh. Emma Wilkins, the second fastest qualifier from this morning in four. Jess Lloyd, City of Manchester in five, and Sian Harkin in six. Those occupy the centre lanes. And Sophie Smith is back for some more. Does she not know what punishment is? She's in lane number one.
Yes, she's a multi-eventer. She is quality over all disciplines, and then now she's trying to hand at 100 metres freestyle. But as we go into the first 50 metres, it is Emma Wilkins of Loughborough University turning in 26.49, closely followed by Olympian Jess Lloyd in 26.86.
That's how it looked after 50, but they're now coming up towards 75, and it's not quite so clear-cut anymore. Emma Wilkins and Jess Lloyd, and Jess Lloyd has just started to get those legs pumping a little bit more as Emma Wilkins tries to respond, but she can't. Down below, Sophie Smith is coming into the mix, but she won't get there. It will be Jess Lloyd in 55.14, and for her, that is just outside her personal best. Emma Wilkins, 55.89 in second, and third is Sophie Smith, who did sneak through as one of the outside smokers there in 56.08. Caitlin McClatchy, 56.11, will have an agonising wait to see if she makes it.
Yep, she will, but commanding swim from Jess Lloyd, winning by over 0.7 of a second. She didn't panic as well. Emma Wilkins went out quick, but she just bided her time, used all that endurance she's got. She did enter the 200 metres freestyle earlier on the week. She wanted to swim quicker, but her main event is the 100 metres, and that certainly did show as she came down that second 50.
Good one for Manchester. She will be delighted. Another good swim from her this week, and 55.14 her winning time. Emma Wilkins in second, 55.89, and Sophie Smith, 56.08 for 1-2-3. Semi-final number two of the women's 100 metres freestyle is ready to go. And are we ready to go with the 1-2-8? Yes, we are. Here it is. Victoria Garlick, Shauna Lee, Grace Vertigans, Fran Housall should be the quickest by far in lane number four. Becky Turner's had a slightly disappointing week so far. She'll be looking to change all that in the semi-final. And Rebecca Guy going for City of Manchester Aquatics in lane number six.
Francesca Housall is our golden girl at the 100 metres freestyle. Let's see what kind of performance she can put in this second semi-final. We can see her there, looking focused. She looks down the pool. She wants to be going under that qualification time of 54.39. She's well capable of doing that.
I thought you were about to say she's capable of walking it, and she pretty much is, isn't she?
Yeah, she certainly is.
54.39. Her British record is 52.87, so that shows you the disparity between those two.
Take your mark.
Well, Fran Housall, if she is right on top of the game, will be a long way clear of anybody else in this field. Rebecca Turner will be swimming her own race, and she'll be hoping to be in there, because obviously we're thinking about a potential 4x1 team. The bad news is there is no women's 4x2 team going to Barcelona, because they did not achieve the time. So we're looking for four women to go quickly here, so there's a possibility of a 4x1, and this is going to be Fran Housall and then the others, really.
Certainly is. Look how far she is at first 50 metres. And this is just a semi-final, so goodness knows what she's going to be like in the final tomorrow night. But she's really going hard. She's got 25 metres to go. She's going to put her time down for the rest of the world to see here that she is in great form. She had disappointed Olympic Games last year, and she wants to put that right in Barcelona.
Let's see if she can get a time that gets her in and around the top five in the world. Fran Housall stops the clock at 54.39. That is just outside her season's best, but way inside the qualifying time for this morning. Second is Rebecca Turner, 55.35. And third place going to Grace Vertigans, with fourth to Rebecca Guy. So Fran Housall, Rebecca Guy finishing in fourth place to the Manchester Aquatics, but Becky Turner, 55.35. Grace Vertigans, 56.09.
That time from Francesca Housall equaled the qualification time for Barcelona, 54.397. That's well in her capabilities, and she did it in the semi-final. I expect her to go quicker in the final tomorrow night. Is that not your swimming cap that she's wearing there, Bob?
Yeah, I don't know where she got that from, and I don't remember lending it to her.
It was out of your shower.
What are you doing in my shower?
What's she doing in your shower?
Might as well wear with your wife if you stick it into my room overnight. 54.39, Fran Housall, Rebecca Turner in second, Grace Vertigans in third, and right down to Rebecca Guy will make it through to the final. Shauna Lee and Sian Harkin miss out in ninth and tenth.
Platypop, Van Houtel.
Here we go then. 200 backstroke semi-final number one coming up next, and we've lost somebody. I think we've lost in lane one. We've got Jonathan Carlisle in lane number two. David Gregory is in three. Ryan Bennett, who was the second fastest qualifier this morning, along with Callum Jarvis, who did pretty well from Bath University in five. So sad to see we only have seven, not the full eight here, Ross.
Yeah, obviously it was too late to call the reserve in as well, which is unfortunate. Yeah, as you say, Bob, we are missing Jonathan Carlisle from the City of Sunderland. Oh no, sorry, we're not. No, we're not. He is in lane two.
Yeah, call me out as well, don't worry. But yeah, Jonathan Carlisle is there from City of Sunderland, as is David Gregory from Sheffield. Ryan Bennett from University of Stirling. He is the fastest in this field at 158.81. Callum Jarvis has yet to reach the dizzy height of a 158. And Luke Wood in seven and Joe Elwood in eight. Neither of them have yet broken the 205 barrier. So a lot to do for them. Ryan Bennett, who has been, I think we mentioned earlier in the week, the nearly man, a 200 backstroke, finished third in the trials behind Chris Walker-Hebber and Marco Loughran. We'll be looking to step up here. Of course, they are involved in the second semi-final, which also contains James Goddard. So, Ryan Bennett, four lengths of the pool for you to show what many people know you can do. It's a question of whether you believe it yourself, and he's gone to a cracking start over the first 50, but so too has Joseph Patching in lane number six.
We were so impressed with Joseph Patching back in March in Leeds. He really did come through, and he was extremely good swimming in Leeds, and he's going to hopefully back that up tonight in lane six. But it is lane two, Jonathan Carlisle, that's gone out in 27.5.
Very impressive start. Patching in second, Ryan Bennett in third. That's pretty good. Jonathan Carlisle's entry time was about 2.05. He got it down to 2.03. His personal best, though, is around about 2 minutes. So we'll see whether he can back that up. He's certainly going for a big style in lane number two. I don't think the boys in the centre lanes are actually aware of what's happening on this side of the pool. They're swimming their own race. They're pretty much in formation in four, five, and six. But Jonathan Carlisle is not reading the script, and he has an advantage of about a second over Ryan Bennett and about a second and 0.3 over Callum Jarvis.
Yeah, and a second at the 100-metre turn, but Ryan Bennett's just got a superb turn and underwater phase, and he's now coming up to onto the shoulder of Jonathan Carlisle in lane number four.
They're going to go to the wall pretty much together here with 50 to go. Has Carlisle just held on at the turn? Very tight. No, he hasn't, because Ryan Bennett's just overtaken him by 14/100ths of a second. Bennett from Carlisle, then Callum Jarvis in third, Joe Patching in fourth. Of course, the eight top times will progress to tomorrow's final, and Ryan Bennett is going to nab his position quite comfortably.
Certainly, he's only got 15 metres to go. If he carries on this pace, he's going to be posting a PB time. His PB is 158.81, so he's looking to go in there, but it does look like he's just backed off a little bit.
158.85, so 4/100ths outside of his personal best, Ryan Bennett, and a bit more in the tank, I think, remaining for tomorrow night. Jonathan Carlisle did hold on to go sub 2 minutes for the very first time, and third, Callum Jarvis of Bath University, so the top two under 2 minutes, and Ryan Bennett under the 159.
Brilliant swim from both Ryan Bennett and Jonathan Carlisle out there in the outside lane. It's not easy swimming in an outside lane because you don't have the rest of the guys to swim off. And he did that all on his own, apart from Ryan Bennett just pipping him towards the end.
Confirmation that University of Stirling's Ryan Bennett wins it. Jonathan Carlisle of City of Sunderland in second. Then Bath's Callum Jarvis, City of Sheffield's David Gregory, 2:01.42. And David will wait and have to wait on tenterhooks for a little while to see whether that time for him, which is just outside his personal best, is good enough.
Representing Newbury, Jake Chisholm. Lane two, representing Stockport Metro, Jake
Semi-final number two of the men's 200 meters backstroke, and here come those big hitters. James Gunnard, who played a very interesting game this morning, Ross. He went flat out for 100, decided to say, OK, I'm going to switch the motor off now, and just cruised in the last 100, so we don't really know what kind of form he's in, but I suspect pretty decent on the basis of that. Marco Loughran in three, of course, he did that fantastic 50 time in the backstroke. Liam Knight, Chris Walker-Heaven, they're all in this lineup.
Chris Walker-Heaven did one of the performances of the week in the 100 meters backstroke. 54.3 in the 100 he did. Top five time in the world. Let's see what he can do on the 200 meters backstroke.
Well, as Celine Dion once said, baby, this is serious. This is where it really matters. No posturing, no holding back, no swimming for 150 here. This is where you have to show your cards. And James Gullard, who hasn't swum 200 backstroke competitively for a while, didn't do it at the Olympic trials last year because he had a clash with the 200 meters individual medley. And now he's thinking that the 200 backstroke, as it was in 2004, where he came so close to a medal in Athens, is actually his destiny. But he's got some pretty good opposition here. Chris Walker-Heaven, Liam Knight, who impressed us in Leeds, Marco Loughran, all in this. Who's going to get the early move in?
It's James Gullard and Marco Loughran. Two and three that are leading out this second semi-final. We've not seen James swim this since 2010 when he won the Commonwealth Games in Delhi. So he's almost retired from this 200 metres backstroke, but now he's brought it back in. He's now dropped the 200 metres medley and just solely focusing on the 200 back.
He is the British record holder, James Gullard. We're going back to suit days, though. 155.58 for that British record. Best time in the world, 154.72 for Ryosuke Iri. But the Japanese and the Americans are pretty much dominating this event at the moment. Lane number two is where James Gullard wants to be, because the others can't really see him, and he's just enjoying being out of sight and out of mind. 57.15 at the turn. Chris Walker-Heaven's moved into second. Marco Loughran is third at the 100 stage. Craig McNally is fourth.
Really determined swim from James Gullard and Chris Walker-Heaven. Opposite ends of the pool, but they've got 75 metres to go. Marco Loughran just being dropped, and now it is Craig McNally coming through in lane four.
Yeah, it's Chris Walker-Heaven who's just starting to make his move in six. In fact, he may well be at the front at the turn. He is. Walker-Heaven from James Gullard in second, Craig McNally in third. Maybe Gullard thinks he's probably done enough to make this a comfortable qualification, but he won't want to get beaten. He'll want to hang in there as long as he can. Walker-Heaven, though, is looking very good in lane number six.
Certainly is. Cracking swim, 53.3 on the 100 metres. He's going to back that up with a comfortable win in this second semi-final. He's going to go into the final tomorrow night in first place.
157.42 is the qualification time for the World Championships. He's done a 157.73. Second to Craig McNally, Marco Loughran in third, James Gullard 2.0025. Which is not rapid by his standards by any means, but it should be enough. I'm sure it will be enough to get him through to the final tomorrow night. But interesting tactics here by James Gullard, if he is in the kind of form we think he is.
Yeah, I think he's just trying to get through the rounds. He's got a shoulder problem that has been niggling for a good couple of years now, so he's just going to be managing that. He's not going to be wanting to really put a lot of pressure onto that shoulder. So if he can get through the rounds without a lot of energy, then that's what he's going to be doing. He's now sixth position going into tomorrow night's final.
Liam Knight claims the last position for the final. By virtue of his fifth finish there, no place for David Gregory, but Walker-Heaven, McNally, Loughran and Gullard all through to the final of 200 backstroke.
Well, that was the men's 200 metres backstroke semi-final. The final will be tomorrow. Now, this morning I was let out of my studio and I went and met the event officer for this event and see what it takes to put on this kind of event. So let's see how I got on. I'm here with Natasha Cuthbert, who is the event officer for the British Gas Swimming Championships this year. And I wanted to get a feel of what it's like to run this kind of event. And we're giving you exclusive access to areas that you may have never seen before. Now, Natasha, we're here in the call-up room, which is quite a unique place to be. What was the thinking about having a call-up room here at this event?
So the call room is the final preparation area for the swimmers before they go out to competition. So it's important that we provide this area in order for the athletes to prepare for the race.
And it's really cool in here and you've got screens up, but this is actually a really nerve-wracking place. The screens meant to help us, or is it meant to make us feel a little bit more like that's what we've got coming up?
So the screens are there to provide the swimmers with the information as to what's going on in the pool at the moment, so they can see what their competitors are doing and also prepare themselves for how much time they have before they go out and swim.
Oh, I have many memories from being in this room, and it does really emulate what it's like when you go out to big international competitions. So next phase would be the racing phase, wouldn't it? So let's head out to poolside and have a go out there. So Natasha, we've just come out of the tunnel. This is the first time that the crowd is exposed to the athletes. Now, as you can see, the pool has really been dressed up quite spectacularly.
Well, Kate, this is the British Championships after all, and what we want to do is create an international environment for the teams.
And there's lots of people to coordinate. You've got the likes of officials, you've got the box boys and girls who brings the athletes their kits. It's quite a lot to organise.
Yeah, we've got over 50 volunteers at this event, including all of the people that you mentioned, and it's important that obviously our role is to organise them to be here at the event.
It must be really exciting for the crowd. They're seeing this incredible event put on. Have you had a good public response?
Yep, tonight we've got a fantastic capacity and we've had a great response from the community around Sheffield to get involved in the event.
And at this point, your job is over. It's up to the swimmers now to get in the pool and do their job, and then it heads over to the medal ceremonies. But we're going to make our way over to the lounge where the athletes can go and chill out. So let's see what it's like in there.
Okay.
Well, I am feeling pretty relaxed right now because we are currently in the athletes' lounge, which is completely different to the cool room and the poolside, which you've just seen. And this is quite a unique thing to have an event, isn't it, Natasha?
Yeah, this is only the second time we've ever done this at a national event. And what we wanted to do was offer the athletes somewhere to come and relax just while they're not competing.
And again, it's a lot cooler here than it is on poolside, and there's snacks. So ideally, it's for just before their race or after their race if they've got another one coming up.
Yep, so if they've had a tough day, they can come in here and hopefully take their mind off the swimming.
It's pretty relaxing here. You're almost worried that they're not going to want to get out of these comfy beanbags. I sure don't want to be.
Well, hopefully they do. What we want to do is just offer the athletes an opportunity to come here and relax and then hopefully perform well in the pool.
And have you had good feedback? They seem to really be enjoying
it. Yeah, really good feedback on it so far.
Well, it's definitely something you're going to carry on with. As an athlete, I definitely would love to see this kind of thing regularly. And that's just the breakthrough things that the British Gas Swimming Championships are doing here. So I think I might just stay here for the rest of the day. I'm pretty chilled out.
Just underway is the women's 100 breaststroke final in the multi-classification. We have S6s, 8-9s and 14s. Nicole Luff, Claire Cashmore and Stephanie Slater amongst them. And we'll be looking to see whether Charlotte Henshaw's record of 138.46 might be under threat from the likes of Charlotte Henshaw. And possibly we will see Stephanie Slater in the SB8 go for Claire Cashmore's 120.37 as they come back towards us on the 100 breaststroke.
We've already seen lots of these girls swim already at the start of the program. Amy Marin's swimming incredibly well this week, as is Stephanie Slater in lane 3, so watch out for her.
As always, times converted to points, not necessarily the winner, which will be visibly here. Nicole Love first in the S14 category. She will accumulate some points. We'll tell you what they are when they're converted. 8.82 for Nicole Love. Second at the moment, Claire Cashmore, 7.99. But Nicole Love in lane 4 has got the most points so far. All the others finishing in their respective categories. Still looking like lane 4 for Nicole Love. 8.82. Claire Cashmore in second, waiting for Charlotte Henshaw and Emma Hollis to stop the clock. 8.49, close from Charlotte Henshaw, but not close enough. So Nicole Luff is the winner in lane 4 with 8.82. Charlotte Henshaw with a 140.86 and 8.49. And Claire Cashmore in third, 7.99. Just looking at Nicole Luff's best time, 121.22. She has done a big new personal best, Nicole Luff, by 1.1 seconds. What a great time for Nicole Luff. And in fact, we make that a new British record as well. Previously at 121.56, that's a new British record in the S14 category.
Cracking swim from Nicole. Just absolutely smashed that British record, taking the win on 882 points. Congratulations, Nicole. That was a fantastic swim.
Really good stuff. And let's see all the different points for all those swimmers. 882 Nicole Love, 849 Charlotte Henshaw, and 799 Claire Cashmore. SB14 Nicole Love with a new British record. It was 121.56, it is now 120.12. If you're going to smash it, you might as well smash it by a big margin. So another British record falls here at Ponds Forge in Sheffield this week. Nicole Love, the latest recipient. Here she is with Andy.
Well, Ponds Forge, how about it? A new British record for Nicole Love. Nicole, they love you. How pleased are you with that?
I'm really happy with the time. All the hard work shows off. And I can't wait for Canada now.
And how pleased do you think your coach, Danny Thompson's going to be with that?
Very.
Well, Nicole, we're going to let you get off and celebrate. Well done. Ponds Forge, new British record holder, Nicole Love.
Well done, Nicole Luff. As she said, she's really looking forward to Canada, where they'll be having their World Championships in the middle of August, and it's clearly showing that she's on personal best times already, and she's not even rested for this particular competition, so it's great to see that they are still on form. We've got the men's race coming up very soon, but let's talk a bit more about Nicole, because actually she doesn't swim any other event. She's very focused on the breaststroke, and that's how these breaststroke events seem to flow. They're very specific to that one stroke, and she's shown that actually they are a lot better and a lot stronger if they stay specific to the breaststroke. Also within the mix there, we have the likes of Claire Cashmore, good friend of mine that I always have to mention, and then Charlotte Henshaw, who is hopefully going to be a medal potential in Montreal in just a few weeks' time. So we will look forward to their performances there. But the next race we have coming up is the multi-classification event for the men's 100 metres breaststroke. So Bob, over to you for the final of tonight.
Thanks, Kate. And we have just five going in this, three of whom are S14 category, and we have two SB9s, Oscar Livesey and Jamie Warriner, going in that category. Scott Quinn, though, the British record holder for the SB14, perhaps he's going to do better than 109 here, Ross.
Yep, better than 109. This is PB 109.00. Qualified on 111.05. So let's see what kind of form he is in. I spoke a lot over the week about these swimmers not being on fully form, they've not rested down for this meet because they have the World Championships in Montreal later on this year, and they've already qualified, so this is about getting some race practice. They're sharpening up a few of their areas that they want to improve on. Hopefully when they get to the World Championships, they'll be flying.
Time that we're looking for in terms of setting a new British record for the S14s is Scott Quinn's 109 dead. And for the S9s, it will be 109.74. No, I don't think either Jamie Warriner or Scott Lives here in that kind of form, but we know by their personal best they're not going to get close to that. So really, we're concentrating on the S14s, and you can as well as you watch Joseph Schenk in three, Scott Quinn in four, and Aaron Moores in three, four, and five. So those centre lanes are all in the same category, so in effect, they're having the same race.
It is Scott Quinn just edging out in front as he comes into the last 5 metres of the first 50-metre race. He's going to want it to be a good tight turn. He's only got one length to go on this 100-metre breaststroke.
Split time for him is 32.80. I'll tell you what, he may not be massively outside, possibly inside his British record of 109. Second place at the turn, Aaron Moores, and Joseph Schenk in third, all in the S14 category. Oscar Livesey and Jamie Warren are having their little battle, which we'll look at in a moment in the S9s. But we need to look at this time from Scott Quinn in lane number four, looking for a 109. Is he going to get close to 109? He might be outside it. It's going to be very, very tight. 110.20 just slipped outside it. 8.57 points for him. Aaron Moore 7.84. So at the moment, Scott Quinn has the most points, 8.57. And we'll continue to have that right to the end because he is the winner in lane four. 110.20 for the British record holder. Second place to Aaron Moore, third to Joseph Schenk. So the SB14s take 1, 2, and 3.
Another great swim from Scott. Lane four, one of those occasions where he actually won the race and he got the most amount of points. We've seen it quite a lot this week. It doesn't normally happen.
Well, it makes it easy for us, put it that way. And when he puts his glasses on pool deck, he looks like one of the proclaimers, waiting for him to do a letter for America. Lovely lad. It's got 8.57. The winning point. And here are the others. Aaron Moore's in second. Joseph Schenk, the SB14s dominating. Jamie Warner and Oscar Livesey of the SB9s. Well done, Scott. Another trophy for him. Aaron Moore's taking second and Joseph Schenk in third. So let's hear from the man who has just picked up the 100 best stroke gold. Here's Scott Quinn with Andy.
So Ponds Forge, your final swim of the night is a big win for Scott Quinn. Give him a hand. Scott, a superb win there. What did you think of the race?
It was much better than this morning's swim. I felt I was struggling this morning, but I'm just happy to go a bit faster tonight.
And how much confidence does that give you ahead of those World Championships in Montreal?
Oh, I'm absolutely buzzing. Can't wait.
Well, we'll end it there, Scott. Many congratulations. Ponds Forge, the winner of the 100-metre breaststroke, Scott Quinn.
Well done, Scott. He's a great character. One thing I do remember about Scott, he has a brilliant pre-race warm-up, which he's dancing around the poolside like he's having a real laugh. But obviously it's working out because he is swimming brilliantly, and I'm sure he will back that up in Canada in just a few weeks' time. Now I'm just going to have a look at our Twitter feed because we've had a little bit of a trending going on, and we've got the likes of Liam Knight. Now it's Sarah McGee, I'm just having a look now. It says, Liam Knight, swim fast, speedy. Ella is refusing to go to bed until after your race. She is so excited. Smash it up, big fella. Best of luck. Well, I can tell you that he did smash up because he's come eighth in his particular semi-final, so he will be going through to the final. So well done to Liam Knight. And lots of other support for him there alongside people loving you. Bob Ballard as well, saying something like your most bizarre Celine Dion quotes I've ever heard, that you're Bob Ballard. I'm not really sure if that's your strongest point, but well done, Bob. People are appreciating your quotes from Celine Dion. Now let's have a look at some of the presentations that we've got coming up. As you can see there, we have the medal presentation. Oh, the medal going round for Claire Cashmore for the 100 metres breaststroke. She's got the bronze medal there. And then next up, we have Charlotte Henshaw. And we've got how breaststroke, I mean, it's quite a technical stroke. And Charlotte Henshaw there, she is a double leg amputee and still managing to get back and forth in a time of 1:40. That's quite an impressive feat, isn't it, Ross?
It's incredible. So much upper body power. Breaststroke is all about the arms and the legs. And a lot of other stroke, it's more upper body. So for her to do that time, just using her arm on such a difficult stroke like breaststroke, it's incredible.
And Nicole there, she's one of our youngsters. She's an S14. And she seems to keep improving. These youngsters, across the whole board, they seem to be able to do PBs in and out of rested periods.
They certainly do. And it looks great for British swimming. And obviously Paralympic swimming as well going in for the next 3 years. They seem to be coming in each competition doing PB, setting new British records, and they're not even rested for this meet because they've got the World Championships coming up later on in the year. So fantastic that they're doing these kind of times at this time of the year.
Because we've spoken a lot about resting and tapering and making sure we're in the best possible shape, especially the able-bodied athletes. What impact do you think it does have if they're coming in? Because some athletes do run better off harder training into competitions.
Yeah, certainly somebody like Hannah Miley will only have a couple of days rest coming into a competition, and that's all she needs. Jazz Carlin is very similar to that. But some of the more the 100 metre guys or the 50 metre freestylers, they're going to take about three or four weeks rest. And in terms of the last week, they're hardly doing anything. They'll complain if they have to lift their fork up to feed themselves. You know, they don't do anything. So different people are different in how much rest they need or how much they want to really feel good.
Were you a diva when it came to resting up for a competition?
Well, you know, no. I was in the middle of the road. I could get away with around about 2.5 weeks of rest. But I could swim well all year round as well, so I didn't drop huge amounts of time. You see some swimmers that literally on 100 metres drop 3 or 4 seconds, so it's all down to the individual.
Yeah, exactly. And I think I was always a bit of a diva. Like, Mum, I'm not moving. I'm staying on my sofa. But I think we're going to have a look at the medal presentation for the men's 100 metres breaststroke. And we have Aaron Moores there receiving the silver medal. He trains down in Trowbridge. And just to remind you that all three of these guys are S14s, and it's just showing the talent that we have in this particular category. It was newly introduced into London 2012, so their times to meet are slightly easier as they have yet to be stepped up. But Scott Quinn there, who seemed to have quite a big cheer, and he's such a chilled out character. And he's got a very unusual pre-preparation warm-up before he races. Did you ever have a bit of an interesting pre-race warm-up, Ross?
It wasn't very interesting, no, but I always did the same thing every single time. And by the time you've been doing that for the last 20-odd years, it gets a little bit boring. But what's his interesting pre-race routine?
He kind of jigs and wiggles and kind of like moves his body in very unusual positions. Not your usual arm swings and arm legs. It's sort of, I think one of us actually was going to try and record it and post it on YouTube, but we couldn't get his permission because he didn't want people stealing his ideas. But he didn't make the team for London, so he's on a big comeback this year. And it seems like that's what a lot of our athletes here are doing this week. Those that may be underperformed are coming back fighting stronger than ever.
Certainly. Disappointing in London, certainly for the able body, they were disappointed with their performance. But you've seen a lot of swimmers actually step up to the mark this year and really take on, grab British swimming by the scruff of the neck and really take them further. The likes of Jazz Carlin, absolutely incredible, the way she's bounced back from a very disappointing year last year. She didn't even get a chance to swim in London because of illness. So the way she's bounced back, and she really has, you know, taken the world by storm this year on those 800 and the 1500 metres freestyle, incredible.
Well, let's talk about some of those that have qualified tonight. And at the top of my list, I've got Gemma Lowe, who will be joining us very soon. So Gemma Lowe in the 100 metres fly, Roberta Pavoni, Yian Lloyd, all of these guys that have maybe swam already this week but have waited till day four to qualify. Is that leaving it too late, or is that just good preparation?
So this is what happens. When you go to a World Championships or Olympics, they're over 8 days. And some people, especially the 1500 metres freestyle, is always on day eight. So they have to sit around, they have to see their friends going through the highs and lows of competition. Some are winning medals, some are winning gold medals, some are crashing out at the heat stages, and they've got to stay level-headed because they know their competition's right at the end. It's the same in the trials. If you're not until day four and you need to qualify, you just got to keep yourself calm and relaxed, and hopefully when your time comes, you do the business.
And I think we've got about 26 places filled now, which leaves only four for tomorrow. Obviously, that's all subject to confirmation. We've got the likes of Georgia Davis, Siobhan O'Connor, all of the ones we expected, maybe Lauren Quigley, not so much.
Yeah, that's right. We all expected Lizzie Simmons to qualify, certainly on the 200 metres backstroke. She didn't qualify on the 200 metres, so we all expected her on the 100. That wasn't the case tonight. Lauren Quigley did a fantastic race, and she now qualifies for the 100 metres backstroke, as does Georgia Davis. So you can see this emergence of young talent coming through, and it's great for British swimming.
Absolutely. Now, just a reminder that we do have our pace clocks still available, and we'll find out the winners of that tomorrow. So continue tweeting in. We've already had quite a few tweets already. First of all, it's for those maybe smaller clubs that don't have access to pacing clocks, and we want you to tweet us, letting us know why you think your club deserves to receive those pacing clocks, because they were at London 2012. And if you hashtag training hard and hashtag BGSC, and we will hopefully read out the winners of that tomorrow. So get tweeting as often as you can. Now, we're very lucky now because we're joined by another exclusive guest, and that is Gemma Lowe, who's had a very exciting evening tonight. Gemma, you've done the qualification time. You must be over the moon.
Yeah, I mean, it's just a massive relief because, as you saw in the 200, I just missed out and made the silly mistake of going slower in the final. And I just didn't want to do that tonight because I just made the time like just so close the night before. And I was like, I'm not making that mistake again. I'm going slower. So I'm just happy that I did the time and now I'm officially on the team. It's just a big relief.
How did you come back from the disappointment of the 200 metres butterfly? We saw you get the qualification time in this semi-final and not in the final. So how did you kind of use that as motivation to come back on the 100?
I mean, it wasn't easy. Like, all I wanted to do was over-analyse everything. Like, why did I swim so slow? Because it was like 4 seconds off my best time. And I've been doing all the work, I've been doing all the training, and I was like kind of baffled of what went wrong. So it was really hard to put that to one side and just focus on the 100 because I knew I had a job to do. So it wasn't easy.
And are you able to come to some conclusions on why you did swim 4 seconds off your best?
Not really. My coach thinks he's got the answer, but I mean, I put all the work in this year. I worked just as hard as ever before, and still don't know if something to do with the Olympics is going on, or just don't know what. Like, just never know with sport, it could be anything.
It's been quite an exciting event so far. We've had lots of people qualifying, and there's been some sort of different, including sort of the athlete lounge and the call room, making it seem like a real international event. Have you really felt that pressure?
I think I have felt a lot of pressure. Like tonight, I was really nervous, and then I just thought, how ridiculous is this? I've been in so many more like pressure situations, like the Olympics, for example. And tonight, I just don't know why I was so nervous, but I think, like, just the atmosphere and just the build-up and, like, the motivation of wanting to still get on the teams and just want to do well for Britain. And I think everyone is, like, improving all the time. There's so many youngsters coming up, but there's always going to be pressure there. So I think it's just great that the atmosphere is that good and that Britain is still fighting back and improving.
You had a great year last year at the London Olympic Games. What are your plans now moving forward for not only for the 4 weeks coming up to lead into the World Championships, but the next 3 years leading up into Rio?
Yeah, I was actually a little bit disappointed with last year. I know I made the final, but I know my best time would have got a bronze medal, and that always hurts me a little bit. My dream is still to go to the Olympics again, and I just keep motivated and keep enjoying it and keep working hard. And the plan now is to get back into training and hopefully do better on my 200. And I think now it can't get any worse than what it went this week, so just keep improving and enjoying myself.
That's great to hear, Gemma, and we look forward to seeing how you get on in Barcelona if your name comes up on that list next week, but I'm sure you will be on there. Thank you very much for joining us.
Right,
so just a reminder again, you can continue to tweet us overnight to ensure that we get your tweets on tomorrow, and remember that pacing clock, we want to get all your tweets and make sure it's a great competition and you do not want to miss out on that prize. Now, Ross, just to finish up for tonight, what has been your standout performance?
Well, I think the two men's and women's IM were absolutely brilliant. It's just, I think it's the racing that really stood out tonight. We had some really solo performances last night with Jazz Carlin, Michael Jameson, but tonight it was about the depth in the field. Four guys and girls going under the qualification time for the World Championships later on this year. So that's brilliant. It's brilliant for British sport, it's brilliant for British swimming, that we can have those guys really pushing each other on. So the amount of the depth that we've got. The men's 100 metres freestyle looks like it's going to be an interesting final tomorrow night. Adam Brown, I don't think, got out of second gear. So, you know, he's going to be on fire tomorrow. And Ben Proud doing PBs every single time he gets in the water. Somebody else that does PBs every time they get in the water is Adam Peaty. You know, he's PB'd on the 50 metre breaststroke three times, the 200 metres breaststroke three times, the 100 metre breaststroke twice. He goes into the final, second quickest tomorrow night. And he's only a young lad, he's very inexperienced, but we'll see how he handles the pressure tomorrow night.
So it's the penultimate night tonight, and tomorrow is going to be the final night. Do we feel like the people that are on the team are the right people, or have we got a few that maybe have got last-minute dashes to make the team?
I think what you've seen this week is the emergence of the young talent. We've already spoken about that. We still see some of the old guard hanging on and doing the business for Great Britain. But I think tomorrow we're going to see a lot of great finals. There's no semi-finals tomorrow, it's all finals. We've got the men's 1500, we've seen Dan Fogg on amazing form this week on the 800 and the 400 metres freestyle. So, you know, expect those places to fill up. There's only four places left. So it's going to be interesting for the selectors if we get more people than that qualify. How are they going to judge it? How are they going to pick what swimmers and who's going to make that team for the World Championships?
Well, you've definitely whetted our appetite there, Ross. There is no reason why you cannot be joining us tomorrow. We thank you for joining us tonight. And if you come back tomorrow, we are going to be on at a slightly later time of 5:45, as there'll be no multi-classification races tomorrow. It will just be finals for the able body to see who will qualify for the FINA World Championship. So do not miss out. We will see you tomorrow, 5:45.
This is where I'll start to lose your backside. You do it.